Baseball has returned to the capital city as the sixth-ranked Texas Longhorns return to the spacious confines of Dishvok Field, seeking its third win of the young season. On the other side, the UTSA Roadrunners made the short trip up I-35, looking to play spoiler. It's the 2015 home opener, and it's next on Longhorn Network. Well, the schedule says it's baseball season. Mother Nature may not agree. Clear skies, but it is a little chilly here in Austin, Texas, as the Longhorns got their 2015 home opener against UTSA. Heaters are active in the dugout. Heaters up here as well. Kevin Dunn alongside three-time All-American Greg Swindell. So glad to be back and get this season kicked off. A lot of excitement about this Texas team. They end up going on the road, taking on a top 20 Rice team. They split the four-game set. What'd you take out of it?
Well, I took a veteran team that came back to go play a tough Rice team, but also have 11 newcomers on this team this year that really showed a lot of mental toughness. Guys that struggled during the games. Brett Boswell striking out four times, getting a big base hit. Michael McCann getting a game-winning double. Kyle Johnston out of the bullpen throwing 96. Showed a lot of mental toughness, and good to see the new faces getting the game.
That's one thing Augie said, too. 17 strikeouts in that Sunday win, but able to come back and overcome that deficit and end up splitting a big four-game set, which will certainly help out RPI-wise. Well, something that's going to help out UTSA RPI-wise is taking on Louisiana Lafayette and beating them 2 out of 3 in the opening weekend, a Raging Cajun team that lost some talent but was number one for a lot of the year last year.
Yeah, might not have been the same Raging Cajun team that was one game away from going to the College World Series last year, but UTSA, the Roadrunners, came out swinging the bats. A lot of home runs, had a good south wind this weekend in San Antonio. Hit the bat, swung the bat really well, and expect to see the same out of them tonight.
Six homers, 27 last year. That wind helped, the new balls helped, but that Coach Marshall thinks they got a little bit more pop. We'll take a look at the starting lineups and get you introduced to this new Texas Longhorn baseball team. It's Texas Tuesday, and it's coming up next. Welcome back. Jason Marshall is in his third year as the head coach at UTSA. Was a All-Southwest Conference player at Texas A&M, was on that 1989 team and played till 1992. Take a look at his lineup, and I guess we got to focus on John Borman, who decided to come back for a senior year, and he's helped out.
A senior leader coming back, drafted in the 19th round last year, decided to come back for a senior year. He is the captain of this team. You see there already in the three games, 2 home runs and 6 RBIs.
They're going to be facing a true freshman from right here in Austin. Went to Lake Travis High School, Connor Mays. He's 6'2", 200 pounds, and he got some action in Houston as well.
He did. One of the newcomers we talked about in the opening of the 11 newcomers. He got an inning in, gave up a couple hits and no runs in Houston. But look at those numbers. A senior here in high school, coached there by legend Dennis Cook at Lake Travis. But shows good mound presence, a good young man that's going to probably play a big part of this pitching staff this year, especially right now on Tuesday. Is a good time to get him a few innings.
It's good to have old 27 Cookie teaching you how to throw. He pitched in the big leagues like Greg did for a long time. One thing that Skip Johnson has said about Connor Mays, he likes that he is fearless. He will attack hitters.
Yeah, he will. His numbers in high school prove that. He did, proved it in Houston last weekend with the one inning. He will come right after. He's not afraid. He trusts his stuff and just believes in his ability more than anything. And that all comes with that mound presence.
Kevin Markham's going to lead it off. Markham has 2 of those 6 home runs that UTSA was able to hit out. You see the junior from Willis, Texas, GAC transfer. Coming in, hitting 455.
Not big, a stature, 6 foot. We'll say 185, but he's coming out of junior college where he did hit a lot of home runs. And the 2 this weekend, I mean, 2 homers, 2 RBIs. He's going to show some power. Today might not be the right place at Dishvokville, although there is no wind. So we'll see what happens.
1-1 back up the middle. C.J. Hinojosa was shaded over there, and there's one out.
The ball dribbled right off the end of the bat, right under Connor Mays on the mound. You'll see him take a little stab at it right there and miss it, but C.J. gets through there quick hands and quick release over to first baseman Tres Barrera.
Trace playing first, so Michael Cantu will be behind the plate. Travis Jones still getting adjusted as a true freshman.
Yeah, I tell you, when you go to the next level, like Travis has from high school to Division I, and you switch positions, it can't be too easy.
No.
I think over the weekend, it might have got to him a little bit in Houston, a little pressure, added some pressure to himself. But
a kid from Humble.
From the area, exactly, in Houston.
That's going to catch the plate for a strike, and it's 0-2 to Matt Hilston, the left fielder. That comes in hitting .333. And also got a home run in the series win against the Raging Cajuns.
You see right there, Connor Mays gets that call in the outside corner and comes right back a little bit further, testing David Wiley behind the plate. Just how far will you go?
Huggy talked about Cantu before the game, how impressed he was defensively, and he said it's one of those guys he played better than he practiced, and some guys are like that.
When the lights come on and you have a different color uniform out there on the field, yeah, Michael Cantu, he doesn't change. He does the same thing in practice. I mean, he's always into each pitch as he's catching. He's on the bench in between the innings. He's always right there. You see this fastball by Connor Mays. Good one after going with the slider low and in. Comes back up, changed the eye level a little bit with the fastball, but good fastball right there.
Here's John Borman. Swings at the first pitch, fouls that out of play.
Borman is aggressive. He will go up there swinging, and we'll go up there looking to pull the ball. He's a local right there in Seguin, Texas.
Yeah, Seguin, Texas. He was drafted, as Zeke mentioned, in the 19th round, decided to come back, and really was thought of as more of a defensive guy. Hit 4 homers last year, already with 2 this season. Almost caught him 1-1. What can Texas fans expect to see from Mays? What type of stuff does he have?
You'll see him challenge, like you've seen him so far to the first 2 hitters for the Roadrunners. He's going to come right after you. Got a good fastball, good slider. We've seen that. But more than anything, for a freshman, he's going to have the mound presence. He's not going to be afraid to get the ball over the plate and let his defense do the job.
Rich Marlowe will make that play. And 1-2-3 go the Roadrunners. So successful first inning at home for Connor Mays. Texas now try to get that offense kicking. We saw some good things offensively. I know you really liked the way they battled, even in the 10-9 loss in the second game, the first game of the doubleheader.
Well, it was so easy at that point. You're down 6-1 after the first inning. And then after the first inning, they won that game. What was it, 9-4? The score was after
right.
That. So it was just the way they got down and battled back. Teams a lot of times can let down. But the Texas team battled back, and just the defense let them down in that game, and Rice was able to score one more run, but they did. They battled each at bat all the way to had the tying run on second to end the game.
And they were down all series, as you can see. Even in the 2 wins, they had to overcome a deficit. I think the biggest thing that you mentioned, 11 Longhorns made their collegiate debut. Augie Garrido told me this is the first time he has legitimate D1 athletes at every position and multiple ones that he can go to since 2005, 2006. You were coaching 2005 when Wheelis was hitting that bomb. That's how long ago it was.
They were pretty good in 2005 and 2006. And if you can be compared to those teams, you're putting a product on the field.
Take a look at some of the notable offensive performers. Who stood out to you?
Well, right there at the top, Ben Johnson with the 5 RBIs and the .444 average, but also Brett Boswell. We talked about him having the 4 strikeouts in the game and then being down 0-2 in his last at-bat and able to get the ball in play and get a base hit and keep the rally going for Michael McCann to come up and hit him in there in the 10th inning against Rice. So that's the mental edge that they're talking about, and you can see that out of your team, especially at this stage of the season, just the first 4 games in Houston. It's going to be a long season, a long grind, and they're already mentally tough.
Take a look at his lineup, Augie's lineup. Ben Johnson will lead it off. C.J. Hinojosa in the 3-hole. Brooks Marlowe has been the guy who has been hitting cleanup. You see C.J., the 2014 CWS All-Tournament team, but off to a little slow start. Augie said that he thinks that he hit the ball pretty hard.
He did hit the ball. I watched the three out of the four games there in Houston, and he hit the ball hard, didn't have anything to show for it. And again, stayed mentally tough, stayed within himself, was able to come off the bench and get a base hit on Sunday and helped his team out. So CJ looking for him to get on track with some base hits tonight. A lot of hitters, they'll go up there, and if they're hitting the ball hard, they'll take it. But you also want to get those base hits.
Of course you do. You want something to fall. Aaron Burns is going to be the guy going for the Roadrunners. 6'4", 225-pounder, big kid. He is a transfer, as you can see, from Temple Junior College, but he originally started at Gerald, Texas.
Really good numbers. 2.65 and 15 walks and only in a lot of innings right there. So he is going to be around the plate. He's going to have a 87 to 90 mile an hour fastball. Coach Marshall says he's kind of nursing a foot, so he will be on a pitch count and inning limit, probably three or four innings, and then see how they can piece the game together after that.
Ben Johnson will lead it off. Ball's in there for a strike. Where can you expect his velocity to be around?
It's 87 to 90. I mean, you think maybe in a situation where he needs to hump up, he can probably go 91, 92 miles an hour.
This is to right. It's going to fall. No, it's going to be foul. Here's what Ben did over the weekend in that 10-9 loss. Ben got it started offensively.
Good little follow through right there by Ben Johnson.
Like
you'll see the same thing right here. You'll see that top hand get through and just enough over that left field wall, which put Texas back in the game right there on Saturday. Just not enough to get them over the hump, but at that point made the game 6-4 when they were down 6-1.
Inside, 1-2.
That's one thing the umpires are going to be calling a lot more this year is if the hitter does not get out of the way and lets the ball hit him. It's obviously not an attempt to get out of the way. Rice over the weekend, two or three times, but they weren't called. So it's kind of tough, difficult situation when you say you're going to call it, then you don't call it. But there were situations where I read where it was called in some games around the country.
Burns retires. Johnson, yeah, that's a rule that needs to be called because it's gotten a little out of control in the last couple of years.
Well, yeah, I mean, now you have the pads. You have the padding that you can wear up there on your elbows, on your wrist, on your shins, on your foot. I mean, if a ball's coming at you, if it's going to hit you, it's not going to hurt. And that's usually sometimes the intention is to make it hurt a little bit when you come inside.
Collin Shaw, senior from right here in Austin, went to Westlake High School. Like Ben Johnson, a very talented athlete in high school. Not sure he had as many D1 rides as Ben Johnson did as a quarterback and a punter, but Collin was an excellent wide receiver, and you're starting to see him get used to playing baseball more as he gets more reps.
And that's what you wanted to see out of Collin Shaw.
It's going to be hit to left, and it's going to fall in for the first hit for Texas.
Just off the end of the bat. But enough to get out over short in front of left. It's what you want to see out of Collin Shaw. We've talked about it since his freshman year. Reps. He just needed to get out there and play. And he had got the opportunity to play last year. And his defense speaks for itself. I mean, he has a highlight reel alone of Collin Shaw's defense. He just needed to hit a little bit. He started to do that, and he was a big reason why that team made it to Omaha last year.
Bring up C.J. Hinojosa. C.J. played in the Cape, so did Collin Shaw. Four Longhorns played in the Cape Cod League this summer, the Premier League. What did CJ work on this offseason to try and really have a breakout junior year?
Well, see, he just needed to hone his skills. He did that by dropping some weight. He worked on his quickness, his foot speed in the gym with Lance Sewell and the guys here at Texas that do an outstanding job of getting these guys ready to be on the field. And I think that was the main thing. CJ just needed that one more half step, and it really shows on his defense in the field.
I think you're exactly right. You definitely see it on that first step at short.
His range has gotten better. His quickness is better. And he's confident. I mean, the kid is, he's a gamer. When the lights come on, CJ's going to be ready to play.
You saw the piece we had on Longhorn Network. Also got a little farming done when he was in the Cape. Lived with his family who lived on a funny farm, a gentleman's farm. CJ had to take
funny,
care.
Funny?
Well, they call it,
like
it,
a,
they
like
call
a clown
it funny,
funny?
No, it's N-N-I-E. Okay. I'm not that bright, Greg. I just figured gentleman's farm, they're not killing anything. 2-1 throw over. Shaw is a threat to run. This Texas team, Augie feels like, is going to be a lot more athletic. And even when we saw on Friday night, Ben Johnson bunt the ball, you rush the throw to second. Well, Travis Jones can run. All that was rushed because of speed.
Exactly. You put pressure on the defense by bunting and running, and Texas is going to do that. They only had the one steal attempt over the weekend at Rice, but this team, Ben Johnson, you know, is yet to be thrown out. Collin Shaw has speed. Who else down there? I mean,
Zane Gerwitz can run a little bit.
Zane can run. He picks his spots. Exactly.
All right, tougher through here, CJ. Let's go, kid.
Shot of Zane. He'll be adjusting to center field this year. We'll get into more on that later. Burns obviously aware of Shaw's athleticism. And then Zeke mentioned Texas only with one steal.
Attempt.
You would think they'd be a little bit more active as the season goes on. Two laced to left field. That is a base hit for CJ Hinojosa.
Breaking ball by Aaron Burns right there. Just again, just off the end of the bat, just enough to get through the infield. CJ muscles it in the hole over there between short and third.
All chance for Texas to get something going.
There's something going right here. Now you got your big man coming up, Brooks Marlowe in the four hole.
What do you think of him hitting cleanup?
I like it. I mean, the guy can hit. He's really matured, especially on his defense in the field with CJ at shortstop and him at second base. But his approach at the plate has gotten a lot better. Not as free swinging as much as he used to be. His eye has gotten better.
His eye's gotten a lot better. We saw that last year. He was also able to hit left-handers a lot better last season. 267 clip for Brooks.
He had a hit in all four games.
Mm-hmm.
One apiece. Down in Houston.
Burns taking a long time, and Marlowe's going to call timeout.
Burns seeing Collin Shaw jump off a little bit. That first pitch, he's going to keep a closer eye on him. That's what you do when you pitch. You change your times, change your looks to second base with runners on. See CJ over there getting a good lead as well.
This is sky high to right field. Bowles is underneath it. Make the play, no tag. Two outs.
See, and even by doing that, Burns can throw the timing off of Brooks at the plate. Even he hadn't thrown a pitch, he threw the one, but you know, just by stepping off and checking the runner at second base, you just throw the timing off, not just the runner, but also a hitter.
Two outs for Tres Barrera. He's won the College Baseball Home Run Derby. Good job beating out his childhood buddy, Eric Gutierrez. Tres hoping that these new baseballs can help out with his home run total here.
I don't think he's going to have any problem with that. He takes a healthy cut. He's going to hit quite a few home runs this year.
This is hit to right, base hit. They're going to bring home Shaw. Here comes the throw. It's 1-0 Texas.
There you go, Mr. Barrera. Talk about him hitting home runs, pulling the ball. He didn't try to do too much of this pitch. Look at the fastball right over the plate. He stays behind it real well. Tres Barrera hitting the ball to right field right there with something on it.
He was 0-for-3 with runners in scoring position and 0-for-6 with two outs this year before that. And
two-out RBI.
Take that.
And this is something Texas did not do over the weekend very well is sustain a rally. I mean, a rally is sending 3, 4, 5 hitters up to the plate at a time.
Brett Boswell. Texas had been outscored 8-1 by their opponents in the first inning.
Six of those in one game.
Right.
But it's eight nonetheless.
Texas is very high on this young man, redshirt freshman. He'll be playing third base, can also play shortstop.
Last year bothered with a hand injury all year, just couldn't get right. But got himself right. You see there, 5'11 infielder from Rockwall. He can flat out hit. And what I'm more impressed about, he's made the switch with CJ at shortstop to third. And the kid is about as smooth as they get over there at third base.
One, one, tried to frame it, 2-1.
I'm talking from batting practice, is working on feet, getting in position to throw the ball. He made some plays in Houston where it's the dribbler that just gets by the mound that's going towards short, where he cuts it off and all in one motion, just like flips it to first base. It's really smooth and fun to watch.
Got in on him, counts even. Yeah, defensively, when you can make that adjustment, if CJ does go pro, would probably be the shortstop next year. But to be able to make that, not every guy can do that.
No, it's a reaction position. Third base is, because the ball gets on you quicker. You're not as deep as the shortstop. Your footwork has to be a lot quicker.
Two on, two out. Count runs full. Ball in the gap here, and something, do some damage done for Texas.
That's the one thing I have seen the difference in the ball this year, is that they're getting down the line, as they're getting in the gaps more. The home runs are going to happen if you get the ball in the air, but the ball off the bat is getting to the gap quicker than it has been the last few years.
Scores and he loses them. Bases are loaded. It's going to bring up the hero of the Sunday game, at least offensively for Texas. True freshman Michael McCann. In the Round Rock area to Cedar Ridge. Big RBI double in the 10th. Texas was able to win that Sunday game 4-3. Talking to him, Greg Longhorn, extra last night, he and Kyle Johnston came in. He's impressed not only that he's 18 and that he's able to come in and he was so composed, but he said, I really knew he'd struck out the two previous at-bats. He said, I used those at-bats. I knew I was going to foul. Like, he was already going through as an 18-year-old what he thought he was going to get.
And 0-for-4 on the game going into that. So, yeah, it's very impressive, the mentality of these young men to not give up. Here you see the pitch and the double in the 10th inning against Rice.
He was looking for it, wasn't he?
That ball was up and in. That ball's right down the line. You see it hit down there off the wall. And emotion. Not only right there, but also after the game, you saw Kyle Johnston doing the same thing. Saw Chad Qualls was here throwing today, and he said he was going to tell the young man, after you get a save like that, you usually go to your catcher. You don't run straight to the dugout. But he was so fired up to get that save, and a very impressive save and an impressive double by Michael McCann.
5'9", 215-pounder, true freshman. He's a three-year letterman for Cedar Ridge High. Team offensive MVP his junior and senior year. He's a career 332 hitter.
That's a good pitch by Aaron Burns. He got the bases loaded, a young freshman coming off the big hit Sunday. Starts him off with the bases loaded with a breaking ball for a strike.
One to short. Go ahead and go to first. Straub able to make the play. Texas is done here in the first, but they get on the board first as well. Tres Barrera going to right field, bringing home senior Collin Shaw. We played one. It's the Horns by one. Welcome back to Austin, Texas. Sunset action, beautiful in certain parts of town, but Dish Falk Field typically is the coldest place in Austin, Texas. So the fans were bundled up. Let's get to Zeke's keys to the game.
Well, for the Longhorns, limit the strikeouts. We saw in the first inning. A lot of strikeouts over the weekend. You can cut those down, put the ball in play, and shut down UTSA early. They did that in the first inning and pick up the pace. It just seemed like a few times in Houston that the game was ahead of them a little bit. Ground balls, the base runners were running them out at first base and just throwing the ball to different bags.
We'll get back to the Roadrunners' keys here. As Tyler Straub tried to bunt for a hit. Well, their first key, I know, was to get ahead early, and they didn't do that, so it's important for Straub and these Roadrunners to try and answer the run that Texas put up.
Yes, because if you get ahead of Texas, I mean, that's what happened to them all weekend. They fell behind.
Peel the first. I believe that's John Bible down there that says, no, John would be at second.
Darren Steers.
Darren Steers at first. Getting around with John before the game and said, now you're going to be behind the plate, right? And John has been doing this for a long time. He has earned his stripes, right?
40 years.
40 years, in fact. We get to a pretty cool story about Mr. Bible and what he was doing 40 years ago this night. Give you a hint. He's pretty close to this area. 2-2 here to Tyler Straub.
Connor May's not missing by much. I mean, the fastballs are just off the plate or just high.
Nice pitch there. Took something off and gets him to chase.
A little off speed right there. Confidence with a 2-2 count. You see Michael Cantu getting ready for it. Expecting that ball to be down in the zone. It was. Tyler Straub swinging right over it.
Matulia step up. Matulia is DHing. Horacio Carrera is a DH for them, but has been dealing with some shoulder injuries. So the sophomore from Kingwood, Matulia, is going to get an opportunity. Chop sis. Nice play by the freshman right-hander. The underhand little Clemens scoop in Texas. The two outs here.
Good play. Sometimes that can be deceiving when you're a pitcher because you see the big swing, and then it's like a changeup hop. You see Connor Mays times his jump perfectly. This is it.
You made that play a lot,
frame.
Didn't you?
Well, no, I couldn't jump that high. I had credit card height. I could jump about as high as a credit card.
Couldn't get a dollar bill underneath there.
I'm hoping CJ comes over the middle and gets that one for me.
Skylar Valentine. Skyler's a young guy from Pearland. They got three guys from Pearland on this team, obviously playing good baseball there in the Houston area. Coach Marshall said before the game, Skyler's a dirt bag, and obviously he means that as a compliment. He's a guy who just can play baseball.
If you're a baseball player and you get called a dirt bag, you love it.
Only time in life when it's a positive.
It means you get out there, you get after it, you hustle, you get dirty. Never get too dirty here at Dishbach Field. There's turf everywhere, but still good on the ground. But look at this. That's a big league name, too. Skylar Valentine.
That's a great name. To frame that. Misses. Mays so far. It's really his first three-ball count so far, but he's been good with first-pitch strikes. Four first-pitch strikes. And pitches. The corner, it's 3-2.
See, even a 3-1 pitch right there, also on the corner. You don't expect a young kid like Connor Mays, a freshman. You expect him just to try to get the ball over the plate on 3-1, but he was painting.
3-2 to the left side. Hinojosa with a tough hop, low throw, and Herrera knocks it down, but Valentine will be safe. That last hop looked a little weird.
Yeah, it came up and handcuffs CJ a little bit. You see him putting his glove up right there, right? That little hop right there, normally you don't get that. Sometimes there's a little ridge on the turf. If you ever walk around the turf here at this ball field, sometimes it can be a ridge. It looked like it hit that, hopped up on CJ a little bit. Unable to get a handle on it. I think that would be an E6.
I think so. brings up T.J. Pickering. Makes the first pitch strike. Pickering hitting 250.
It's something this UTSA Roadrunner team needs. You know, the top of the order, pretty heavy. They got the big hitters up there. If they just get something going, I know there's only three games in the season, but you want to get the bottom of that order on base to roll it over to Markham and Hillston and Borman up at the top of the lineup.
The top of the lineup, 1 through 4 veterans, all juniors and seniors, and you go 5 through 9. You've got Pickering, who's a sophomore, and you've got, at most times, they're going to have 3 freshmen in the lineup. But as Coach Marshall said, they're the best players. These are my guys. So
you put your best team out there, the best team to give you the opportunity to win. And right now, 3 games into it, this is it.
1 ball, 2 strikes, 2 outs here in the top of the second. Kevin Dunn, Greg Swindell, home opener for Texas. Horns 2-2 on the year.
Same thing was said by the man in the first base dugout as well.
Right.
He's going to put the team he thinks has the best opportunity to win out there, which normally you do, but he's saying Michael McCann's in the lineup. He earned that to get back in there. Michael Cantu's behind the plate. He likes his presence and the way he runs the pitching staff.
Ball's in the dirt.
And is able to block pitches like he did right there.
Valentine will take second. Yeah, he's been impressive so far for Texas.
Right now you have a true freshman on the mound, a true freshman behind the plate. So he's going to set up inside right there. And with his size, he's 6'4", he's able to get out there. Yes, the runner was probably getting the second anyway, but he could stop him from going to third by getting in front of that ball.
Count runs full to C.J. Pickering. True freshman from Corpus Christi. May is a true freshman from Lake Travis. Almost said Lake Austin.
They're close.
Yeah. Pickering from Houston, went to Westside High School. It's one of those younger guys in the bottom part of the lineup. This ball is hit to short, and Ahosa going to take his time on this one. And the Roadrunners strand a runner at second.
The long
2014 College World Series, a magical year for Texas. A year after they did not win a single Big 12 series, they finished third in the country. It was a magical run that included beating Rice and Texas A&M to win the Houston Regional, and then went all the way to Omaha. Fell short of winning the program's 7th national championship. And there may be a lot of years, Greg, you finished second twice, that come back and you feel like, that's a fact. You came back and you had to feel like, man, we should have won it. Last year you finished third and everyone was patting them on the back. It really felt like they turned the program around.
Well, they did. Just to make it back after the 2 years prior to that, not even making a tournament, not even making a regional tournament, they caught fire. They started playing good baseball. They gelled as a team, and that's why you're out there. You play as a team, and the starting pitching, Nathan Thornhill, your closer, John Curtis, you miss those guys now. So that's where you're going to have to find. Texas is known for having closers.
Mm-hmm.
You're going to have to find that this year if you're going to win a lot of baseball games. You're going to have to find out who your other starters are. You know that Parker French is going to be there. Chad Hollingsworth is making his way back. Who's going to be that second guy? Who's going to be your Tuesday guy? Connor Mays is throwing the ball real well. Bullpen is pretty solid. They were at least over the weekend at Rice. So I think the biggest question mark this year, which is something you don't hear too often here at the University of Texas, is their pitching. who's it going to be? Who's going to step up? And if they can find the right people to step up and do the job, they have a real good opportunity of making it, back to Omaha. It just happens to be if you're going to play good. I mean, at that time.
Right.
Texas, in my opinion, was one of the best teams in the country last year after watching them all year not playing that well. They just became a team later in the season, and it took them all the way to third in the nation.
A lot of his teams have done that. When you have that man, Skip Johnson, if you're going to have a question mark with the team, as Cantu fouls that past Tommy Nicholson with a rare error for number one.
What's he doing down there?
We take a look at the starting pitchers against Rice. We've got Parker French, what he was able to do, and he did not get the decision, but pitched very well. Casey did not have the outing. What did you see from him?
He was just, I think he was timid. There was a lot going on. He was in Houston. Dad was there. I'm not making excuses for the young man because he's a gamer. He'll get out there and battle you all the way.
Cantu's going to be on first as Burns loved it, but just couldn't squeeze it.
As far as Casey goes, it was just a matter of not settling down early in the games. Right here, Michael Cantu, just off the glove of Burns, legs it out. Casey, just balls were up in the zone. Almost seemed like Rice hitters knew what were coming. And sometimes you're out there on the mound, you're going, man, do they really know what's coming? But after that, you got to tip your hat to the kid because he settled down. He gave up maybe one or two more runs after that. Settled down after the first inning. Was able to give you three. And just nerves. Him and Sawyer both. I've watched Josh pitch some inter-squad games. He just seems very comfortable and just seemed just a little on the edgy side. The slider, the hard curveball that he has in inter-squad just wasn't as sharp.
You didn't have that. Your first outing, you came out and you were pretty dominant from the beginning. Why not have nerves?
Well, you always, if you don't have nerves, you're not human. I mean, you're going to have them. It's just how you can maintain them and contain them. You can't let the pressure get to you. I mean, every game I went out there, I was nervous every game. Just didn't let it show. And my first game ever here, I only went 3 2/3 or something like that. It was my second game.
That's the second game.
Out in Arizona State, where I didn't have time to get nervous.
Gerwitz has been showing bunt. Zane played a lot of third base last year, the sophomore from San Antonio. I mentioned Valentine being the dirtbag for UTSA. I believe Zane Gerwitz would get that award for Texas. Going to play center field this year. But right now, trying to get the bunt down. Take a strike. Every baseball team needs a Zane Gerwitz.
I'd take nine. Zane Gerwitz is, yeah, the kid can play. He played third base last year and struggled in the main part of the season in the regional tournament down at Rice.
Yeah.
But was able to keep his composure, mentally tough, be able to come back and play well.
Sacrifice, so he gets his job done, and Cantu will move up to second. Cantu, one of those guys Texas fans really were shocked to get on campus, probably. Kyle Johnston would be another one, even though he wasn't drafted. He made sure he was not going to be signable. I think Cantu pretty much gave the same vibe to the major league scouts.
Yeah, Michael Cantu, I mean, you look at him. He's always looking for the fielding position. Now he's looking down the bullpen, see if anybody's coming in from down there. The guy's all over the place.
First of all, look at him. He's 6'3", 237.
So he's 15 shoes.
Right, and he's
huge.
He's just a remarkable kid, too. Was a quarterback, finished, I believe, in the top 10 in his class, and had perfect attendance from K through 12. Did you have one grade that you had perfect attendance? I know I did.
I did 1 week.
We're gonna have a pitching change here. We'll let you know who the new Roadrunner hurler is when we get back. Texas leading 1-0. Welcome back to The Dish. Texas leading UTSA 1-0. We're here in the bottom of the second inning. One runner on second. That'd be Michael Cantu. And one out for the new pitcher, Jared Hodgson. Hodgson is a left-hander from right around here. Bastrop, Texas. Was a Bastrop Bear and 6'2", 185-pounder.
We'll see what he's made of up here in Austin, locally, like you said, from Bastrop. First appearance of the season. Left-hander expected to come on, probably pitch two or three innings. We're only in the second inning right now.
Both these teams coming off their first weekend. Texas playing four games and UTSA playing three games. I think both pitching staffs are going to probably use a lot of people tonight.
Yeah, I know Texas plans on pitching about six pitchers tonight. Connor Mays expecting to go three. And then about 1-1-1-1-1 the rest of the way out. I can assume. Well, you never assume.
We've learned not to do that in baseball.
Exactly. But I'm sure the Roadrunners will do the same.
Ben Johnson, the leadoff man. Grounded out to the pitcher. Back in the first.
Wouldn't think Michael Cantu would be stealing third right here, but kind of was a little jumpy right there.
Well, Straub and Valentine, the middle infielders, are thinking along with you. A good pitch to hit and fouled it back.
Didn't miss by much. Healthy swing by Ben Johnson. Strongest, according to Lance Sewell, could be one of the second strongest athletes in the school.
Who's first?
I would imagine Malcolm Brown might be.
Oh, you're saying on campus?
Yes.
Wow.
Pound for pound, we'll put it that way.
Go for one. It's going to be 0 for 2. Hits that to right, and Cantu back at second. The two outs, and that'll bring up Collin Shaw, who singled back in the first inning and then came around to score the only run of the game. Collin in his senior year here. Played for the Kituit Kettleers in the Cape Cod League. Travis Duke and Tres Barrera also on that team.
Always wanted to go play at the Cape. Was going to after my freshman year. Got selected to go tour with Team USA that summer.
Oh, tough break.
Well, yeah, we did end up going to Cape Cod and playing a couple games, so that was fun.
Lefty, lefty. How has Shaw been against lefties throughout his career as he continues to progress?
He's been hitting a lot better. I mean, when he started out, he struggled trying to pull the ball off lefties, but now he's got it more of a tendency to stay in and hit the ball to left field, which is, in my opinion, what every left-handed hitter should do off a left-handed pitcher. Try to drive the ball up the middle or the other way.
It's 1 for 5 against left-handers this season. 1 for 6 with two outs. Drop that one in there for a strike. Now, there was some talk about Shaw maybe moving to center to replace Mark Payton, but clearly defensively and offensively that's going to be a big big absence for the Longhorns. But with Gerwitz proving he can play center, Augie thinks right field's the toughest spot to play because of the sun and everything that goes into it here.
Well, Collin's played a pretty good right field since he's been on campus. He knows the angles. He knows the right path to the ball.
Sticks his bat out. Coming over is Jackson, and he will make the play. Texas strands a runner at second. They still lead 1-0 after two. Welcome back. Opening night here for Texas baseball. Texas Tuesday. Longhorns lead the Roadrunners 1-0 as we head to the third inning. Some brave Longhorn fans dealing with the cold. If you're at home in the heat watching us, smart move, and thank you very much. Take a look at UTSA, the Roadrunners, what their program history is all about. Their first year of baseball was in 1992. They've had three NCAA tournament appearances, including 2013 when they won the WAC and were knocked out by Texas A&M. This is their second season in Conference USA. But just looking at what they were able to do against Louisiana Lafayette and talking to Augie before, so you're going to try and do, he said, no, we're going to try and win this game. This team can play, and this kid can pitch.
It's teams now on Tuesdays. Back in the day, you padded your stats on Tuesdays. I mean, teams that came in here, you beat them up pretty good. But now with the parity and all the everything going on in college baseball, these teams that come in here can flat out play. They're not anything you can just fold up. Augie's got his starters. Coach Marshall has all of his, the guys he's expecting to go out there and win him a ball game. So it's big.
Deontay Jackson is up. He's a junior from Sugar Land via San Jacinto. That's off the end of the bat. And barehanding it is Brooks Marlowe. What a play for the first out.
Brooks Marlowe playing back in regular position. This is really all Brooks Marlowe can do right here. The speed of Jackson getting down the line. If Brooks happens to go down there with a glove and try to transfer it into, you know, glove to hand, he's not going to be able to. So a smart move, a veteran move. I mean, the guy, what, one error last year?
He was phenomenal.
That wouldn't have been an error if he wouldn't have been able to come up with it. That was just a heads-up play by Brooks Marlowe.
And it's even harder. It's harder if it's rolling and it's straight still to pick it up. But that had some spin on it because there was some funk coming off the bat. Trent Bowles now up. Bowles, the nine-hole hitter, playing right field. He's a freshman from Katy. We mentioned the bottom of this lineup. They really like, Coach Marshall likes the talent and what these guys potentially can do, but they're clearly young. He did say these guys actually drive the ball more than the top of the lineup does.
Right. Well, the bottom of this lineup is something they're going to depend on. I mean, obviously, throughout the season, this is that ball hammered to left field. Ben Johnson doesn't get a good read on it at first.
No, Ben didn't read that well. Gets over his head. That's not easy to do. Bobbles it a little bit, but Bowles will stay at second, and that's exactly what Coach Marshall was talking about. These kids can drive the ball.
That pitch right there. One of the hardest plays for an outfielder is a line drive right at you. You don't see too many as a left fielder, but this ball is just on a line right at Ben Johnson, and it just takes off. Hear the sound of it. Look at that ball. It just carries. You don't see Ben Johnson misplay too many balls like that. That one there just got over his head and just kept going. Nice swing. Nice double by Trent Bowles.
First hit of the game for the Roadrunners comes from their nine guy.
With him on second, that bowls it over to the top. Kevin Markham.
Markham grounded to C.J. Hinojosa to start the game off. Two home runs for Kevin Markham.
See right here, you see Ben Johnson, the ball's right at him and it freezes him. That's the hardest one to judge, the one that's right at you. And Ben Johnson does the right thing. He froze, but that ball, once it got up in the air, it took off over Ben Johnson's head.
Boswell, the long throw, and it goes safe. Beats it out. Barrera thought he got him.
It's just pure hustle right there. Kevin Markham getting down the line. Not an easy play. You see, it also has some spin on it. That little hesitation for Brett over there at third base to transfer his weight to get something on that throw.
Good call.
Was able to get Markham hustling down the line.
Well, Coach Marshall told us that Markham ran a 6.460. So Boswell obviously knew I need to get this over there quickly, did all he could, but that'll be the second consecutive hit and second hit in a row, or for the game, for UTSA. Only positive for Texas with that, Bowles having to stay at second base. And that'll bring up Hilston. Matt struck out his first time up.
Bring Skip Johnson with a slow stroll out to the mound. You could think Connor Mays could be getting a little tired. I mean, 40 pitches isn't that many, but he only had the one inning in Houston.
Ty Marlowe and John Malman getting loose in the Texas bullpen as we take another look at that play at first.
See how he is safe. You see how Tress goes up, and maybe if Tress could have went out a little bit more.
Mm-hmm.
But he's shorter in stature than Travis Jones. Travis Jones maybe could have gone out and got that ball with his height. But Tress had to just go up instead of out. But good hustle by Kevin Markham to get down.
Two on, one out for Hilston. Upstairs. Houston, a junior from Spring Branch, went to McLennan Community College.
They look down at the bullpen with Ty Marlowe and John Malman getting ready.
This is hit towards right, very high, coming over is Collin Shaw, and he's going to run out of room.
That's what I'm talking about right there.
Pretty good effort there.
It was a very good effort. You know, the other side of that fence is concrete walkway, so he's not worried one bit about that. You'll see right here, he's just going to give it up for it. Nobody there to help you? You gotta brace yourself and get back on the playing field. I mean, he dove into that.
Well, it goes from I want to catch this to now I really don't want to fall on my head.
Right.
Self-preservation. Mentioned Shaw played a lot of football in high school. He's a pretty tough kid.
Good job, Connor Mays, right there.
CJ.
Well, CJ's he's jockeying out there for the runner, but a lot of young pitchers would throw home right there with shortstop just wide open. So Connor Mays did a good job of stepping off and now letting CJ get back to his position.
Fastball. And two liked it. It's 2-2.
Connor Mays wants to get through this third inning. You go out there knowing you only have three innings and got a couple runners on. You might start pressing a little bit to try to get out of the inning too soon.
Maybe trying to see if you can't get him to roll one over. Texas second in the nation last year in double plays.
That's something that's been fun to watch. CJ Brooks out there up the middle. They turn a lot of double plays and they make it look not easy, but just comfortable, you know?
Make a lot of stuff look routine that is not. 2-2, could they get it?
Good call, Parks.
Marlowe and Ahosa, 4-6-3. Well, they were second in the country last year. It wasn't that tough of a call. Connor Mays able to get out of it and doing it with his slick middle infield. 8-9-1. Welcome back. Texas trying to heat up the offense a little bit. Chilly night here in Austin. Hopefully better weather this weekend as you can tune into LHN as sixth-ranked Texas will take on Minnesota in a four-game weekend series. Game one of the series begins at 6 Central on Friday. You can catch all the games on Longhorn Network and also watch ESPN.
It won't be chilly for Minnesota, I know that.
No, this would be a joke to them. Coming off of a three-game sweep at Houston is Minnesota. Houston is a pretty much a consensus top 10 team in the 11 polls that we all look at, but Minnesota played pretty well for the most part. They're obviously getting tested early.
I can't imagine they've been outside too much.
Exactly.
Being able to practice up there in Minnesota, if you've watched the weather lately.
How many fly balls have they seen?
They probably do have a bubble, but I wouldn't think not too many is they were hit down there in Houston. But Houston does have a good team. Minnesota's going to have a good team. And it'll be fun to watch. I mean, they haven't been here in a while here in Austin.
Yeah, actually a lot of tradition if you look at Minnesota in the Dave Winfield time and era. They played some pretty good baseball at times.
Paul Mulder.
Paul, yeah. Who was the other one you gave us?
Dan Wilson.
Yeah, I didn't know Dan. I knew Paul and Dave, obviously. 2-0 to CJ. CJ in his last two at-bats is 2-for-2.
After the over 13 start. No, like we said, he did hit the ball good in Houston, just didn't have anything to show for it. Stayed within his game and walks too.
And for the second straight inning, Texas able to get the leadoff man over. You don't see too many cleanup men bunting, but you'd think Brooks will be laying it down here.
Had one in Houston. I would imagine he would have one here. He's about six away from being third all time. He would pass the man in the third base coaching box.
Tommy Nicholson. Brandon Lloyd leads that list.
Brandon Lloyd had a lot of sacrifice bunts when he was here.
Todd West had a lot, too, who played with Tommy.
That Ball comes out of the box. There's Tommy Nicholson. Had a few sacrificed bunts in his time. He played some pretty good infield in his time.
Also hit, I believe, 360. He could hit some line drives.
Hit a little bit in his time. Check out the bunt here by Brooks Marlowe. Watch it come up off the turf.
Uh-oh.
See, it hits him in the helmet, but he's still in the box, and it hits him again down the line, but it's foul. Usually if you're out of the box and the ball hits you,
that's an out.
You're out. I think that back foot is still in the box.
Not able to execute, so 0-2. Saw Pickering at third. Really crashing in. Brooks trying to get the bunt down the first base line.
Yeah, normally, with less than two strikes, you would try to get that ball down the first base line, but if he gets the bunt call again, now you just want to put it in play.
No balls, two strikes. Hosa at first after walking. Jared Hodgson in for relief for Aaron Burns.
Throw over. Maybe seeing if Brooks would show bunt right there with two strikes. He didn't. Long stare in there. So that would have been a testy one right there.
Yeah. But
Brooks is smiling too because he had a tendency to leave that shoulder with the pad on or the elbow. Leave it in there.
He's having a little chat there.
See
too.
Right here, he's like thinking about it. But to me, that's an attempt to get out of the way if it would have hit him.
Three and two.
Working a good at bat.
Oh, what a difference a couple of years makes as a senior. Brooks, he got down 0-2 his freshman sophomore year. It was trouble.
He's hacking. Getting concentration. Something Augie teaches these guys, just have a plan. Every pitch, have a routine getting into the box.
3-2 to right. Going back is Bowles. Going back, and he makes the play. Ball looked like it may have had a shot off the bat, but not a shot here.
No, takes a lot. Maybe in a month or so if they get a little different wind, but tonight the flags are still colder weather. They put a charge into it. And now it makes it exciting, kind of, when there is a pop fly, it has a chance to get out of the ballpark.
It's got a shot.
See all the flags around the park. Got on the buses behind the fence.
Well, Greg, traditionally the ball will carry a little bit better here as the weather gets a little warmer.
Yes, it does. Because the wind also shifts. It comes out of the south, southwest, and goes from right to left.
Barrera to left on his horse is Hilston. Going back. It's over his head. Coming around is Hinojosa. CJ will score, and it's the second RBI for Barrera. It's 2-0 Texas.
Smile on Tres Barrera right there. First at bat, hitting one hard to right field for an RBI, and this one right here. See something he just wants to turn on. Gets that elevated just a little bit more, but that's a line drive. The ones I've talked about that's getting over the outfielder's head this year. We saw it last inning by Bowles for UTSA, and right now for Tres Barrera. Two line drives getting over outfielders. We haven't seen that the last couple of years.
I think your points is really well taken, and something that's not talked about a lot. Obviously, it's the home runs, but it's other parts of the game that will speed it up and allow the ball to travel a little more, including balls just getting through the infield.
The ball by Bowles, that ball last couple of years would have been an out. The outfielder might have had to go back a step or two, but they would it would not have gotten over their head.
Here's Brett Boswell. Brett walked his first time up. redshirt freshman from Rockwall. Had a wrist injury last year, so he had to redshirt. We've talked about his defense offensively as a left-handed hitter. What did you see in the fall from him?
Smooth. I mean, just like his fielding. He's just a pure hitter. He's got a natural swing, good left-handed swing. He can hit the ball to all parts of the field, not just a pull hitter.
Last ball blew it by him. Well, he was one of those guys who showed some mental toughness, was 0 for 4 and then hit a double in that.
0 for 4 and down 0-2 in the count.
Yeah. Down 1-2 in the count here. Stays alive.
It's also going to be an adjustment for him. I mean, he's played summer ball in Santa Barbara.
He had a really good summer.
Yeah, he has. I believe he helped Santa Barbara again to a national summer league championship.
He's off of that, 2-2.
If I'm Jared Hodgson, I'd come right back with that pitch. Just a little closer to the plate. You saw Brett Boswell offer it that one. Throw it again in a little closer spot. It'd be tough for Brett to lay off of.
Brett is 3-for-5 with runners on this young season. Count runs full.
Yeah, with the heater. It's a good little fastball, 89 miles an hour.
I didn't think he had that with the first spinners he was throwing up there, but.
A sneaky 89.
Aren't all you lefties sneaky? Outside of Randy Johnson, maybe. All right, 3-2, one out. Texas leading 2-0, one run in here on the Barrera double. He's at second. He chased that one, got him to go. Boswell's out at first.
See, threw a good 2-2 pitch, the fastball low and away, and came back with that curve. It's a tough pitch for lefties to lay off of. He had Brett laying off the one earlier in the count, but that one just couldn't lay off.
Jeremy Filipic getting loose in the Roadrunner bullpen. Two outs for Michael McCann, a true freshman. Michael grounded out to short his first time up. Michael will catch her eventually, but with Tres Barrera and Michael Cantu, it's kind of tough to get in there, isn't it?
Yeah, it'll be real tough, especially now with Tres at first. Michael Cantu, a true freshman behind the plate, might be really, really tough.
But Augie loves him offensively. Feels like he's going to be a big part of this team. That was a good pitch to hit right there, 2-0, and he was looking for it, but fouls it back.
Took a good swing.
Two balls, one strike, two outs. Ball shot, foul.
Hudson takes a little something off of that one after the 2-0 swing. Throw a change up in there. Just off the end. Michael McCann out in front of it just a little bit. See if he comes right back with it.
How's that? Field line.
That fastball right there looked 100 after that changeup. A good idea. I mean, that's always the best pitch. It's safe for left-handers after you throw that changeup away is to pound the fastball in. So we'll see right here if he, true to form, you go right back away with the changeup. So the wiggle come there first sign. We'll see what happens here. He didn't like it.
Two and pulled the string on him and got him. Texas does get a run, but they do strand Barrera at second base. Well, we've seen some more offense already this year. The new college baseball season begins with a big change. It's a new baseball. We asked the Texas players about the impact of the new ball.
The ball last season had higher seams on it. The one this year is going to have really low seams.
I guess the main thing you'll see is the ball is going to fly a little bit farther because there's less air resistance.
Now that we started hitting the ball, hitting on the field, and actually got into live scrimmages and stuff.
Gotcha.
The ball's actually, we can see the difference, the ball taking off the bat, and hopefully college baseball is a lot more fun to watch this year because of it.
For the pitchers, you might be able to throw a little bit harder, and the movement's going to be probably a lot more drastic than the old ball.
I think on a fastball, I throw a sinker, and so it sinks a little bit more, but it's not too much of a difference, if any.
I'm a sinker-slider pitcher, so for my sinker, you get a lot more late action to the ball than normal.
I think this will benefit hitters a little bit more because obviously the ball is traveling about 15, 20 feet further, but in order for that to happen, they're going to have to square it up pretty good.
I don't think it's going to make that big of a difference with, you know, ground balls getting through or line drives getting through the gap. I think you're going to see a difference when someone gets backspin on the ball. It's just going to carry about, you know, 10 to 15 more feet, and that's what's going to make the ball go a lot farther. You've seen Collin Shaw hit some home runs. You know, the home run king, Tres Barrera himself, you know, he's finally able to hit a home run out here.
They're easily traveling 15, 20 more feet. Been a big difference, I think.
I don't think in Omaha it's going to make a difference, especially the first few games we played out there with the wind blowing in that hard. It's not going to matter what ball or what bat you use. I could, you know, be playing at shortstop and you're not going to burn me on the field.
Well, here we are. Here are the two balls, two different baseballs.
That's the old one, the higher seams on there. This is the new one with the lower seams. It's funny how every hitter or pitcher has a different view of it. You heard Ben Johnson saying that the line drives and the ground balls won't have much effect, but if you get the topspin on it or the backspin on it, it's going to go further. That's been proven. They've put both of these balls into a pitching machine, shot them out at 95 miles an hour. The new ball does go 20 feet further, so if you do hit it, it's going to go a lot further in the air with some backspin on it. And I like the ribbing that they gave Collin Shaw there, saying the home run king, because he hasn't had a home run, but this new ball might help Collin Shaw. He'd get that first one this year.
And then dig it on Tres Barrera a little bit, right? But I want to ask you as a pitcher, because offensively a lot of people have talked about it, but we've heard Parker say the sinker may get late action. Why?
The lower seams. I mean, the same thing when you hit the ball. I mean, the air draft or the, you know, what stops the ball also stops the sink or the rotation of the curve ball. With the lower seams on the new ball, it just gives you that much more, I'd say, later life on the ball.
Those are runs per game, and already one run more as Ty Marlowe is going to be the new Texas pitcher. We'll be tracking that all year long, try not to track it too much and still focus on the game, but the game needed a little bit of a jolt, and we'll see if this gets it. As take a look at Ty, who missed most of 2014 with a UCL and now is back.
What a great thing right here. Not easy for a young man to sit out a full year and go through arm problems, but he's fought back, got his way back now to get on the mound. This is his first time to be out there in a really long time. See the fastball at 87 miles an hour. That's harder than what he was throwing before he got hurt.
Yeah, sometimes you come back from those injuries and you're throwing a little harder, but correct me if I'm wrong, his out pitch was that changeup.
Yes, which we could see right here with a 1-2 count. Right after.
Goes back to the fastball. And he's facing arguably their best hitter in John Boorman. Boorman is 0-for-1, flew out to right. But you can see 364, two homers. Senior captain, who was drafted in the 19th round
That's one thing about Ty Marlowe, is he's not afraid. You always hear that about some pitchers. He doesn't have overpowering stuff, but just because he doesn't, can't overpower, he's not afraid to throw strikes. He's not afraid to get the ball around the plate and compete. Skip Johnson likes pitchers that can compete, and Ty Marlowe is one of those guys.
There's the changeup. Gets beneath Cantu. Well, it's almost like a right-handed Travis Duke. Nothing's going to blow you away except usually the numbers.
Exactly. Well, he really does. He really likes to be out there. That's why it was so tough for him last year to be injured and to not help that team make it to Omaha, but he's back this year.
Ooh, watch out. Caught him in the head, and Trace is trying to calm him down a little bit.
I'm not sure Ty Marlowe's right now, but I mean right. I think he might have something going on, which would be a shame. The way hard work he's had to come back.
His brother, Brooks, has already motioned to the Texas bullpen. He put his hat out there. And while they talk with Ty, they are going to bring in what looks to be a lefty, be John Malman. Never want to speculate, Greg, but it's with all the hard work that Ty has done to get back, like you said, it'd be a shame if he is not able to pay it off his senior year.
Yeah, you work hard to get back to this point, and you've thrown in the fall, you've thrown so far this spring, and it's your first time out into the competition with a different team. Your adrenaline's going, you're going to put a little bit more into your pitches. Just hope it's nothing too drastic for Ty Marlowe.
Obviously try and update you if we get an update. Right now you just hope that whatever it is short term.
A lot of times coming back, the scar tissue in there, could it just snap some scar tissue? You're hoping that's the case of Ty Marlowe. It can feel like you re-injure it, but it's scar tissue that's breaking up. I haven't gone through it, but I've heard pitchers say it feels like what happened before, where the injury happened, and it's that painful.
I just think about arms too. All the innings you threw, you never had one surgery.
No, not a mom.
And there are 17-year-olds that have surgery because there's too much wear and tear. Well, as our director just pointed out inaccurately, you weren't throwing real hard, so.
Yeah, I wasn't. But I could throw it where I wanted it.
Yeah, you certainly could. Well, here's John Malman, speaking of lefties. John had a very good weekend. He was part of that bullpen that came in and did some good things. What did you see from 29?
He did great. Well, he got the ball around the plate. His command of pitches has been John's fault, I guess you could say, or why he didn't throw very much last season. But he was around the plate. He's got a good fastball, but the command issues were the main problem. And now he's going to have the opportunity to get out there and pitch. He pitched in Houston at Rice, against Rice University. I mean, they're one of the best college teams in the nation. And he did it, and he did it with confidence, and was able to be effective. And that can carry on for the rest of the season. And all the lefties, the entire bullpen did great, and he was part of it.
6 foot, 180-pounder from Troy, Texas. He is a sophomore. Played at Troy High, pitched all 4 years there.
He's coming off a good summer. He had a good summer ball.
How much does summer ball play into the momentum and confidence you take into the fall and then hopefully take that into the spring?
Well, when you haven't pitched that much at this level, and you go out and now you're facing the same type of competition. It's Division I and players from other schools, but you're able, the main thing in my opinion is you're able to get on the mound, you're able to get 25, 30, 40 innings. I mean, that's what you need to gain confidence. That's what you need to gain your pitches. I mean, to get the feel for everything. And that does carry over to when you come back to your university and you're able to get back out there. And the last time you were out there, you had confidence in yourself, and it just carries over.
Kevin Dunn, Greg Swindell here. Tyler Straub at the plate and takes a first pitch strike. Tyler struck out.
On the end of that play, you're just glad that John Warman is okay down there after getting hit in the head.
Yeah, that could have been two guys going out there. Barrera will give it a look, but run out of room. Trace always seems to be having fun out there. Yet extremely serious about the game.
Exactly. And sometimes players can be faulted for the smile. I mean, but he's that way whether he's 2-for-2 or 0-for-2. And not throwing a runner out. I mean, the guy has fun when he's on the field. It's his way of relaxing.
Good stop by Cantu. What a luxury. Go back to the 2004 team. Texas had two major league catchers on the roster in Curtis Thigpen and also Taylor Teagarden. Obviously way too early to speculate on that, but they've got two very fine Division I catchers, and maybe three if you count Michael McCann, excuse me.
That's pretty good when you can have a guy who caught your entire season last year just go to first base and have another true freshman come in and take his spot. Tres Barrera did an outstanding job, really grew and mature handling a pitching staff. That's what Augie Garrido likes already about Michael Cantu after just having him back there for two games.
Cantu from Corpus Christi. One of those guys. Coaching staff wasn't sure if they're going to get him on campus. Texas has only lost one recruit the last 2 years to the major league draft, and that would be Trey Ball, who went seventh overall.
Usually going to lose that guy.
Yes. Big pitch coming up here, both the Roadrunners and John Malman. Well, one on, 3-2. Center field. Gerwitz has it. Going to try and throw behind Foreman, but there's one out.
That ball laced out to Gerwitz in center field. It carried. I mean, that ball carried a long way, almost to where Zane had to hop up in the air to catch it. Ho-hum. Just another out there. Look like yawning out there.
Yeah.
In center field.
You never know what like when they've got that serious backspin, they take off a little bit on you.
Yeah.
Mitchell Matulia. Matulia. Rounded out to the pitcher's first time up. DHing today. Coach Marshall thinks he has maybe around 11 options somewhere in there. That would mean three extra options off the bench. Augie may have a little bit more to work with this season. That's one of the things that Augie was really fired up about.
Well, yeah, in years past, I mean, you threw nine guys out there and you hope they stayed healthy. There wasn't much depth.
Including last year.
Including last year. I think throughout the later part of the season, there was one pinch hit in playoffs and through Omaha. There wasn't much bench action.
One ball, one strike, one out here in the fourth. Texas got a run in the first and a run in the third. Both from Tres Barrera. Runner takes off, foul tip.
Coach Marshall trying to create offense right there. He's got the left-handed Malman. The left-handed Matulia move the infielders around. Maybe he can find the hole. Now Matulia's in a hole, 1-2.
Not hit well to the left side. Boswell's only play is at first.
That's the play right there.
There it is. That was smooth.
He comes a long way from his position at third base. It's a tweener. It's called the in-betweener between the pitcher, the shortstop. I mean, watch this. I mean, just all in one motion. The transfer from glove to hand puts himself into position and just nice and easy. I mean, it made it look easy.
He made that look a lot easier than it is.
Smooth. I mean, he's very smooth with it. As smooth as he is, it makes it look easier than it, like you said, than it really is. That's a tough play.
The transfer and the footwork, good stuff there. Skylar Valentine up now with two outs, the freshman. Looking to get the Roadrunners on the board. That's over. C.J. Hinojosa coming around to score. The first run of the game for the Roadrunners is Borman, and it's 2-1.
It's by Bauman. Just gets in, but Skylar Valentine able to drop his hands in. You see there. Drop the hands, stayed behind it. Just enough over C.J. Nice line drive and an RBI.
Two-one now as Roadrunners have cut this thing in half. C.J. Pickering, sophomore from Houston, rounded out to C.J. His first time up.
Jason Marshall, coach over there at UTSA. Try to get another one here and get Skylar Valentine in motion. Tough to do off a left-handed pitcher, but with two outs, you're not going to get him in the scoring position. You never know.
Got a pretty good lead over there. Strike one to Pickering. To center. Hurwitz will come in, get under it. And the Roadrunners are done here in the fourth, but they do get on the board thanks to Skylar Valentine. Just over the outstretched arms of C.J. Hinojosa. UTSA is on the board. We got a ball game at the dish. Texas is holding on to a 2-1 lead over UTSA as we head to the bottom of the fourth inning. Always colder at the dish. 48 degrees on the big board. We got that wind tunnel whipping in, and those people are dressed up, and they should be. Pretty cold down there.
Well, we were in the booth earlier during batting practice before we went down the field and talked with the coaches, and it is. It's a good 20 degrees cooler on that field than it is up here. So I'm glad you have that heater down there.
You mean the one you keep on asking me to turn off?
The one that's keeping you warm.
Michael Cantu will lead off for Texas. 8-9-1 due up for the Horns here in the fourth. Cantu singled his first time up back in the second.
Gotta get a good pitch right here. We saw Michael McCann earlier with a 2-0 count. Take a good swing. Let's see Mr. Cantu take a big league hack at this
one. Off speed.
Full respect right there.
It is.
2-0 breaking ball. Thinking the same thing. Very good pitch.
Augie said Cantu has hit lefties better than righties so far early in practice. 3-1. Michael hit 352 for his career with 14 home runs and 109 ribbies at Moody High School. One of those programs that have been playing good baseball for a long time. So reach the seats. He was drafted in the 30th round by my Chicago Cubs, but that was a flyer because he was thought to be top three rounds if he was signable. Pretty impressive kid, though. Was seventh in his senior class.
Smart.
A lot of stuff that I wasn't or not. Loses him. Another leadoff base runner for Texas. That is the third one they've had in four innings. Two of those walks.
Roadrunners don't try to crash right here, because I would think that Zane would be bunting Michael Cantu to second base, but Michael Cantu, not as speedy as most, take a shot at getting him at second base. Before that, we'll get a visit. Looks like from Coach Marshall.
Well, I'll give you a little.
Go to pin.
Give you a little props there. I thought maybe he's going to go out there and let's talk about what we need to do defensively. But he's going to bring in a new pitcher, and I'm sure they will talk about how they want to handle a possible bunt from Zane Gerwitz. Well, Gerwitz, a lot of good things his freshman year, including playing third base for the team, but also did some good things offensively. Augie thought about maybe moving Collin Shaw into center to replace the great Mark Payton. But Zane Gerwitz is going to be the guy who is going to get that first crack, so Shaw can stay in right, and so far so good for Zane in center field. Well, no one can replace number two. It's going to take a couple guys probably to do that.
Oh, yeah. You see him defensively. He did it all. He was a smart base runner. He was a very good hitter, a very smart hitter as well. That's a game winner right there. And the team captain, he spoke off the field, he spoke on the field, and all around, just a real good guy. It's going to be very hard. I mean, whoever is out there, like you said, Zane Gerwitz is the one out there right now. It's hard. Look at the career numbers from last year. Just those numbers on him. It's going to be really, really tough. Is it Gerwitz can be that guy? But Mark Payton did. All year last year, it's his entire career. We just talked about how just a good guy he was. He came to the yard ready to play every day. And for someone to replace him is going to have a lot of big shoes to fill. So not just because Mark Payton was smaller. he did a great job. It's going to be a tough thing for whoever. But Zane can do the job. If they do decide to move Collin Shaw over there, he'll do a great job. So it's just a matter of who it's going to be for Augie. I think you can try to find out who that person is going to be right now before you get into conference play. But I'm comfortable with Zane Gerwitz out there. I would have called Mark Payton a dirtbag as well.
Oh, he is definitely a dirtbag. He would be as dirty as Nick Peoples and some of the other Billy Bates guys we've seen, but there is no dirt on the field. Jeremy Filipek is the new pitcher for the Roadrunners, 5.40 ERA. Jeremy's a 6'3", 195-pound senior. He's from British Columbia. He then went a little south to Midland JC, and now is at UTSA. If Texas with a chance to try and get that run back that UTSA took in the top half of the fourth inning, one on, no out. Expect to see Zane Gerwitz bunting here.
I think from the right side, and that arm angle is a little tougher to bunt on than Hodgson was. Bringing him in, he's got 3 1/3 innings already this year.
Cannot get that bunt down.
A little tougher to pick up.
And different movement too, right?
Different movement. The lefty was, Zane could pick the ball up easier. Try to bunt it. This here is not easy, not an easy thing to do. Tough to pick up. As a hitter.
See Pickering at third. He continues to creep in. It's in there for a strike, and it's 0-2. It's stop behind the plate by Borman.
Earlier in the game, you saw Brooks Marlowe unable to get the bunt down and then eventually popping up. Now, Zane Gerwitz, a couple attempts, not able to get the bunt down. He did his first at bat.
Good pitch, just misses, 2-2. That'll might do it.
Yeah, a little nasty slider. It is. Philippic hides the ball well. You can see that from his delivery. Hides it behind his back. Tough for the hitter to pick up, and it just sneaks out late with the short arm action.
2-2. That runs full. Texas struck out 42 times in Houston in the four-game set. A lot of that can be contributed to, or attributed to, Rice pitching, which is very good.
That's some pretty good arms.
This is skied to left. Underneath it is Hilston, and there's one out.
Yeah, Rice threw some arms out there. No one was under 90 miles an hour. Had a kid back, Stevens.
Jordan Stevens. Towards ACL, the Houston Classic, the game we called
that. Going 95 miles an hour. So just to have him back is great for an already good stat.
When you say back throwing, I don't think Jordan was throwing that in his. I think Jordan's 92, 93. You get that 2 mile per hour bump after TJ, right?
I think I'm going in.
Yeah, maybe you should have gotten surgery.
I might get up to 83 now.
There's Ben Johnson.
Nothing straight from Philippe. Breaking balls, sinkers.
Johnson 0 for 2 after hitting 444 in the four-game set in Houston, including a home run. 11 total bases on the weekend.
Philippe, one of those pitchers you have to be real patient with because he is throwing a breaking ball almost every pitch, or a fastball with a lot of movement on it. Nothing has been right around the plate. Be patient with him. You might get that one pitch that you hit.
The batter's been a lot more patient. First time through the lineup, 5 saw 4-plus pitches. Second time through, 7 saw 4 more pitches.
Seen some pitches. Very good stat right there. And Augie talks about that as well, taking good at-bats, seeing a lot of pitches, going up there with a routine.
This could be trouble to left center on the run, and this is going to be in. Cantu is going to be sent around. The relay throw coming in, not in time. 3-1 Texas.
I was watching Mr. Cantu, and I was also watching Mr. Johnson.
I thought he'd be catching.
Good thing Mr. Johnson was watching Mr. Cantu, because this ball took off good as well. Not a real big swing by Ben Johnson, but he puts it on the barrel of the bat, and it gets out there over the outfielder's head. Ben Johnson. Right about there, so Michael Cantu wasn't as far as expected. Look at this slide right here.
Good slide.
Goes around Borman. Gives a fired up sign out to Ben Johnson. Everybody's fired up. Sawyer, Marlowe.
Take a look at Markham. Coach Marshall said Markham ran a 6.460. I still thought he was playing too shallow there.
Yeah, that ball was hit. It was hit well by Ben Johnson, but he had to go a long way just to get to it.
Shaw hit.
Yeah, that ball didn't even get to the warning track, so that tells you how shallow he was playing. So that's the case right there where Collin Shaw didn't get out of the way of the ball, but that was going to be a ball anyway.
Yeah.
And a breaking ball coming into you. See right here, Collin Shaw, the catcher's outside, breaking ball inside. Not too much of an opportunity to get out.
If it's spinning, stay in, right? If it's fast, try to get out of the way. C.J. Hinojosa. Two through five hitters tonight really have been the difference. UTSA has struggled, won a score to run, but the meat of the lineup's been good for Texas, including C.J. Hinojosa, who is one for one with a single and a run scored. Advancing will be the base runners. Throw down, not in time. With one out, that's a big one.
Longhorn base runners have been working on is the ball in the dirt. See Ben Johnson right there. That ball does not get very far away from Borman, but with the aggressiveness and the good break of recognizing the ball in the dirt, Ben Johnson, with his speed, able to get to third. Collin Shaw, seeing Ben go to third, is able to make the second.
It's a wild pitch on Filipek. Nothing is straight.
There hasn't been, I haven't seen any. 2-0 pitch, Ben fouled off, might have been a straight. That's about it.
Sefcik, the lefty, getting warm. The UTSA bullpen, as we mentioned, expect to see a lot of pitchers on this Texas Tuesday from both squads. And it was a pitch to hit, that hung up.
I like the 2-0 swings that McCann took, like a 2-0 pitch right there that CJ took. Just spinning off just a little bit, but they're nice aggressive swings.
Like you said, CJ hit about 6 or 7 line drives this weekend in Houston, but right at people. It's going to be a souvenir. Two balls, two strikes, two on here. Texas with a two-run lead before a little separation.
Good one here for Tony, CJ.
Fight another one off. These are good pitches by Phil Peck. Inside, CJ has that inside-out swing. He's able to fight them off. Balls in on his hands pretty good.
And some guys, Derek Jeter is one of them, and they almost like that pitch. Two two. Actually, he had Shaw in a rundown at second as Johnson did a good job getting back, but Shaw was in between second and third. But luckily for Texas, Filipek did not look.
I think Collin thought that Ben had the contact play, contact meaning any type of contact by the hitter. The runner takes off from third base, but Ben wouldn't get by the pitcher. Collin didn't. No harm, no foul right there. 1-3 put out. Coach Marshall will go back to the mound.
Maybe go get the lefty for the lefty. LHN brings you coverage of Texas women's basketball. Watch as Big 12 Freshman of the Week Brooke McCarty leads the Horns against Big 12 foe Kansas State. It's Texas Hoops Wednesday at 7 Central on Longhorn Network. Also watch ESPN. Very talented freshman class, including Brooke, also Ariel Atkins. Karen Aston, definitely a bright future for this Texas women's basketball program. Texas men's basketball in action, of course, tonight in Norman. We'll keep you updated on that one as much as we can as the baseball team tries to win their first one at home of 2015.
The home opener.
Home opener.
You can get a chance to do the alumni game or see these varsity squad, the Texas Longhorns, this year because of the weather. This is our first opportunity in the booth to see these guys, and it's fun to be back in the booth.
It is.
What a wonderful booth we have up here.
Great job by Brad Sheldon, our director, who totally redid this booth. We've got a bunch of room. As you look at Doug Sefcik, he gets loose. to take on this Texas offense. Well, let's go and take a look at this new booth. Pretty neat stuff, and we've got a lot of room. I mean, just
actually
lean back and
stretch a little bit.
Have fun, stretch.
Got a nice
good job, Mr. Brad
LHM
Sheldon.
Bats back here.
Yeah, pretty cool
personalized
stuff. Well, and we're all excited, obviously, because it's 2015 season. But I think what Texas was able to do in 2014, finishing third and really making that run, what's the next step for this Texas program? How do they get back there and win it this time?
Well, they have confidence in themselves. And that's what this team learned last year. They learned how to play, and I brought it up earlier, they play as a team. I mean, a lot of times in the years past, there were a lot of individuals that were in that dugout, and the players knew it. The ones that were playing for the team knew it. And these guys just have kind of gelled. And it's the leadership that Nathan Thornhill had last year, Mark Payton had last year. It's carried over now. Parker French is back to lead his senior year. Collin Shaw is back to lead his senior year. And that's how things carry over from year to year when you have guys lead like that. And Brooks Marlowe, one of those same guys.
I don't think you can overstate the importance that Mark Payton and Nathan Thornhill had as seniors turning this thing around culturally last year.
It's amazing that they do come back for that one reason. They want to make it to Omaha. They want to be the ones that help turn the program around. And they did. They took a team to Omaha that wasn't expected to do too much. And that says a lot for their character, and it says a lot for the guys underneath them that listen to them. And now it's their turn to turn it over to the guys and keep it going now.
2-0 to Marlowe. It's been much better against lefties the last couple of years, last year and through the fall.
It can't be too comfortable right here. 2-1 now on Brooks Marlowe and Tres Barrera on deck.
Nice pitch, 2-2.
A slow bender.
Probably not exactly where he wanted to locate it, but it threw him off enough.
Yeah, just from his angle, where he's throwing the ball, it's coming out of his hand behind Brooks Marlowe. Tough to pick up with the spin on it. That one up.
-46 degrees now on the big board. Temperatures dropping here. Still got some diehards who decided to make the trip out. See the horns. Open up 2015 at home.
It's baseball.
Why not? Brooks staying alive.
Can't live with it too long. You got to get that ball either further away from Brooks Marlowe because he's just fouling him off, but he's also leaving him right over the plate. Where if he leaves another one, Brooks seen it enough, he might hammer.
Two balls, two strikes, two outs, two on. He's not fooling him.
just fouling him off enough. And a good job by Brooks.
Has flown out to right twice. Eighth pitch of the at-bat. Just fouled. You got the sandwich for that one.
Look at that. Brooks is putting together right here. Sure you want to hit.
See how close this was. Enough to get the Texas bench up because they didn't have a great angle on that. Two, two. Nice play by Valentine to snag it. Marlowe with a heck of an at bat lines out to second. Texas strands two in scoring position. They do get a run. We're talking with Augie next.
we welcome you back to Dish Fog Field. Right now, we are honored to be joined by the head coach of the Longhorns, Augie Garrido. Augie, and we ask you about, do you know the extent of Ty Marlowe?
Well, we don't know the extent of it, but what we know is he has a groin pull. He did it on the second pitch, so he finished the hitter, and hopefully it isn't too serious.
All right, and with that said, on the other side, Brooks Marlowe not getting the hit right there, but put together a very good at-bat against a tough left-hander.
That's what we want. We want quality at-bats and good competitive at-bats, and that was a good inning. The ball that CJ hit was in the right direction to score the run. Pitcher just made a good play on it. And then Marlowe's at-bat was really good as well. And that's what you can do in this game.
Thank you so much.
You bet.
Coach Garrido, always fun staying warm down there. But that was a really good at-bat, and that's one of the things he likes to focus on is maybe not the end result as much as the process.
Yeah. He hit it well, just right at Valentine at shortstop. I mean, at second base. And I guess in a good way, it wasn't Ty Marlowe. It wasn't his arm. But a growing pull for a pitcher, still not too comfortable.
I was really glad to hear that, though. Not maybe something else. Giante Jackson is 0 for 1, steps to the plate. And grounded to Brooks Marlowe back in the third inning. John Malman out for another action here. And Malman, as you said, his problem early on in his career may have been finding the strike zone. That has not been a problem in 2015.
He's throwing the ball well. You see the confidence in his face. Gets the ball, has a plan. Even in between innings, he was down there throwing some more in the bullpen just to stay loose, but also to get his mind right. You see there, he takes a nice deep breath.
Had to snap one off. Jackson was not chasing.
But he has a plan each pitch. You see right there, he collects himself. It's not just getting the ball and throwing it. They're making quality pitches.
Almond from Troy, Texas. Texas could add some pretty good left-handers this year. Kirby Bello gave them some good innings. Ty Colbreth was excellent. And drive, base hit. It's past Marlowe. And
left that one up over the middle of the plate. Right here, the pitch from Malman. It's up and out over Jackson. Extends his hands. Good job driving up the middle.
Packing is Trent Bowles. Trent is a freshman from San Antonio. He doubled back in the third.
Bullet to left.
Yeah, that was the first hit for UTSA.
It's a good pitch right there by Melman. Saw the aggressiveness of the first pitch from Bowles and comes back with a nice curveball, just misses.
Big kid, 6'3", 190 pounds. Nice breaking ball for a strike.
Sometimes you can hang them enough. I mean, that was a good pitch, had a good bite on it, but it was up, but it was just slow enough. You see Bowles just out, Bowles just out in front of that pitch just a little bit. So we come back with a better one. Get this one down.
Still got it up. Needs to be a little higher to get us there, buddy.
We're ready, though. You are. Waiting on that first one.
I think it may sting tonight a little bit. Just joining us, Texas leading 3-1. Texas with a run in the first, third, and fourth inning.
In the fall, what have you seen from any of these lefties, maybe even Malman, with their move? Getting there?
Mediocre. Yeah, but I mean, it's supposed to look the same as you go to home plate. Most runners these days just go in that first look, first movement from the left-handed pitcher. And Malman's able to make it not look the same, but he's keeping it close enough. You just mix up your times and mix up your throws over. You see Michael Cantu right there. Once you catch this ball, he wants that fastball up. And look at this. That a boy. Exactly where he wanted to pitch. He executed it.
Elevated the fastball and got Bowles to chase. Top of the lineup now to third. Boswell will get the lead out. I can see the smooth nature you're talking about over there. It's
impressive.
Pretty clean.
He made sure right there he got his feet in proper position. You see right here, he knows he's going to throw it to second base. Gets the hop, gets in position, makes the good throw to second base to make sure he can get one out right there.
Two outs for Matt Hilston. Hilston is 0 for 2, struck out, and grounded into a 4-6-3 double play to end the third inning.
And Boswell down at third base, his demeanor never changes. He's just cool.
And they said he's a pretty quiet young man. I asked C.J. Hinojosa, I said, describe his game. He just said, he's a baller. That's about it. TSA is 2 for 8 with runners on tonight. They do have the very fast Kevin Markham. Mentioned earlier, Coach Marshall, but he ran a 6.460. If you're not familiar, that's fine.
So you throw over a couple times here, you'll get him.
Two outs, you're thinking something here, aren't you?
Two outs, you want to get into scoring position. You got a lefty up, lefty pitcher. Breaking ball count. Everything is in the runner's favor, in my opinion, right here.
He's going to take off towards right center. Moving over. And Shaw is going to take that from Gerwitz. We're going to talk with Jason Marshall when we get back. Welcome back. Texas leading UTSA 3-1 as we head down to the Roadrunner dugout now and talk to Coach Marshall. Coach, you know, big series against Louisiana Lafayette where you take 2 out of 3. Where do you feel like your ball club is right now?
Well, you know, it's early and it's, you know, kind of hard to tell. But Lafayette for the last 10 or 15 years has always put a good team out on the field. So we were excited to take 2 out of 3. Obviously, that ball club won 58 games last year. They've lost some guys, but to beat Lafayette opening weekend was we were definitely pleased.
And Coach, talking to you before the game about your catcher, John Borman, how pleasant is it to have a senior leader back with you this year?
Well, you know, he went in the 19th round, and to have a senior catcher back just to secure the battery, especially on the weekends, because we have a Friday and Saturday starter back as well. So. Just to have that combination back is huge for our team, especially moving forward into Conference USA play.
Coach, thanks for the time. Good luck this year.
Thank you.
Jason Marshall. All Southwest Conference player at Texas A&M from 89 to 92. He's an excellent job in his third year. What's up?
Said he was on that 89 team with Texas A&M, but he did a lot of sitting behind a guy named Chuck Knobloch.
Yeah, it's funny when you sit behind guy like Knobloch. Here's Tres Barrera. Had RBI hits on his first pitch. Both of them. Catches the corner. Tres back for his sophomore season. After having an excellent freshman season. Even if you don't do anything offensively, if you can catch Division I pitching as a true freshman catcher. I think that says a lot.
It says a lot about your person. Exactly. You're exactly right, Kevin. To be able to have the maturity to come in and play for one. Now you worry about your hitting. You worry about, you know, that you're at bats. But the most important thing, in my opinion, again, is how does a young man like that control a pitching staff? I mean, you not only have to know what they have or what's working that day, but you also have the full bullpen, every starter.
Their attitude.
Their attitudes. I don't think anybody had too much of an attitude to Tres Barrera.
Yeah, and I didn't mean that. I just meant more their temperament, you know, how you fire them up, whether you can yell at them or you have to go out there and be nice to them.
Right.
Trace finally retired tonight. It's only the second inning that Texas has not gotten a leadoff man on.
The third baseman, number 17, this is Brett Boswell.
Here comes Brett Boswell. He's 0 for 1, struck out back in the third, did walk in the first.
He's bunt a couple times in Houston. Got a tough lefty on the mound. Let's see, maybe right here if he can not try it.
Well, it's a good idea if you look at Pickering at third.
He's back. Second baseman's playing back. You can pull one with you. Going up there hacking.
It's fouled away. Well, you mentioned that 89 team. He was a freshman on that team, but Texas A&M had some really good teams with Mark Johnson. Did a excellent job for a long time there. And then also Jim Lawler, who was his longtime pitching coach for 21 years, his son Brett Lawler is the pitching coach here. And enjoying that right there as you take a look at Brett. Even looks like Jim.
Yeah, they do.
And then Jim Blair, the associate head coach, he played at Baylor, graduated in 2000. He hit close to 370 for Steve Smith.
There.
Jim Blair, he coaches the offense. So UTSA is a nice coaching staff put together here and a lot of Texas ties.
It just shows the last few years the way the program has turned it around, winning the WAC the only year in it, going to a regional, getting beat by Texas A&M. In that regional.
Had to be bittersweet. Probably more in the bitter part.
Sefcik lulled Brett Boswell to sleep on a couple curveballs and then painted an outside fastball and got him looking.
It's up to Michael McCann. McCann 0 for 2. From just north of here in Round Rock, went to Cedar Ridge High School. Grew up coming to the dish and dreaming of maybe getting a game-winning hit one day. How about your first collegiate game?
How about that?
That was, of course, at Reckling. Now he's going to come back, and this is his first game at the dish. Pretty good defensive catcher. Probably not going to see him catch too much this year. Fair ball. Well, that looks like he's back at Reckling. Rips one down the left field line for a stand-up double. That was pretty similar.
It was eerily similar.
Yes, it was.
Wow, fastball up in the zone. He said a stand-up double. He almost had to slide right there. His ball's up in the zone. You see him keep his head on it. Hammers it just inside the left field line. About a foot. He's down to second base.
I think the scouting report may be pretty quickly that he will hit the inside fastball and yank it.
The high heater. Don't throw the high heater.
Different batters now for each.
He hits two doubles.
It's up to another freshman now, Michael Cantu. Gerwitz the only exception on Texas batter not to reach. Cantu skies one to right. Bulls is underneath it. And Texas is done. A two-out double, but the Roadrunners get out of it.
Open up.
Well, Dish Falk Field started in 1975. Of course, Billy Goat Hill was so famous at Clark Field. And the switch to the dish was remodeled about 15, 20 years later. It was thought of as pretty much the place when it was built in 1975. Now, 40 years ago tonight was the first game against St. Mary's. It was a doubleheader, and two umpires, John Bible and Randy Crystal. John Bible is at second. Both of them are calling. There's Mr. Bible. They called that first game 40 years ago today at the dish.
That's amazing. It's amazing that they're still out here and they enjoy it. You see the smile right there by John Bible. They enjoy what they do, not only baseball, they're very good football as well. I believe both of them might have retired from football, but to be here 40 years, they've seen the changes in the field. They've seen the changes in the student athletes. And amazingly, only two coaches have come through here. Two head coaches have come through here.
That they've seen, exactly. There's Randy Crystal, who's at third. And I'll say this, two of the nicest guys you're going to meet. Randy still does college football officiating. And they're out here because they love it.
Yeah. And you have to. You have to love it if you've done it for 40 years, or are going to do it for 40 years.
Tyler Shimp, the new pitcher for Texas, a freshman. He's facing John Borman. Borman flew out to center, was also hit by a pitch. Shimp, big kid, 6'4", from Sacramento, was a highly recruited kid. But a three-hit shutout with 16 K's in, K's in the state championship game. I'll take that.
100 K's and only 56 innings of work his senior year. Very good athlete. Yes, pitchers are athletes, especially here. These guys are big. He's 6'4". Got a good fastball, 87, 90 miles an hour with a curveball and a changeup. A lot of upside. One of those freshmen that are going to be counted on, depended on.
Borman's the guy to watch out in this lineup. 364. Those two home runs over the weekend against the Raging Cajuns when UTSA took two out of three.
Tyler able to get in his first game over the weekend in Houston as well.
Oof.
See a big curveball right there.
And that was 12-6. Just outside.
Just outside.
Hung that one up. Everything I've heard about Tyler, and you certainly would have seen a lot more in the fall, that the stuff is really impressive.
It's very impressive. You see the curveball right there. Like you say, you call it the 12-6. That's just a straight yellow hammer, yak, or whatever you want to call it. I mean, it's a good pitch to go along with a good fastball.
And then that fastball looks a lot faster even when you elevate it like that.
He's been elevated with all of his pitches so far this inning. I would imagine he's a little nervous as well, pitching the first game in the home whites. But taking a big deep breath right here and throwing that 12-6er again. Shaking off the heater, he wants the curveball.
Let's see if he goes to it. 2-2, he does.
No call.
Thought he was going to get one there.
David Wiley might be calling those just a bit up. All the pitches have been up. See where Michael Cantu is. Just off the plate as well.
Got him, 3-2.
Went right after him with the fastball. Tyler Shipp can breathe a little bit now. Like well, he might have thought could have been a little bit more on that fastball. He was out in front of it just a little bit, but Tyler shouldn't be able to get his first out here at home.
Gets the corner on that one.
You got to stick with it. Even though you're not getting the call when you're throwing good pitches, you keep throwing them and get the feel for it. You're seeing it right there. Another good bend on it, but just a little up.
Yeah. It was up to Straub. Tyler is 0 for 2. He struck out. So far, I've been very impressed with Cantu behind the plate as well.
Yeah, he's such an energetic young man. I mean, you see him at practice, and he's always talking. He's always getting people fired up, even in inner squad. He really enjoys what he's doing out there. See, whispering something right there to Tyler Shimp. Now, come on, get the curveball down for me right here. Concentrate. He's always talking, always in someone's ear.
Two, two to Straw.
A cutter.
If he gets a cutter with the four-seamer and that yacker and can spot him, watch out. 3-2. Out of play. Kevin Dunn, Greg Swindell, Texas home opener, leading UTSA 3-1. Roadrunners come in at 2-1 after taking 2-3 against Louisiana Lafayette. Texas is 2-2 after splitting with Rice. He's going to lose him. And that'll be what Tyler probably is working on early on in his career, like a lot of freshman pitchers, just staying consistent. And like Connor Mays has done, attack.
Staying consistent right now. It just seems like he's fighting his mechanics a little bit right there, trying to rush through it. When you start to rush as a pitcher, your front shoulder flies open a little bit and causes your arm to have to try to catch up, which is 99.9% of the time it's not going to do. Flew open right there, and arm couldn't catch up.
Gets past Cantu, and moving up would be Straub. Good chance for Mitchell Matulia. That is a wild pitch. Mitchell's 0 for 2 tonight. He's grounded out both times up.
Michael Cantu heading out there, getting their sign straight. First time with a runner on second with a new pitcher. Find out which one he wants to use. First, second, third, indicator. Which one is it?
Travis Duke getting loose.
Jake McKenzie there in the foreground, loosening up. We'll see him tonight.
Duke gave up one run last year. And stopped by.
Very nice stop.
Cantu. Skip's going to come out and talk with his right hand. I think you may be seeing some of the mechanics you're talking about.
It's just rushing. Rushing through his, see there, right there, that front shoulder. That front shoulder leaves, it's tough for that back, your arm to catch up with it. And when it does, that speeds up. But Michael Cantu back there, knowing a fastball is coming, not exactly where at the moment, does a good job of keeping that runner on second base.
CJ getting the signs down with the freshman, with Straw up at second base. And Tulia, the guy up at the plate. Good chance here for the Roadrunners. One out and a runner in scoring position.
Good opportunity here with a 2-0 count for the Tulia. Sometimes you can be effectively wild. We'll see if that's the case for Tyler Shipp.
3-0. On four pitches. Second straight walk after striking out Borman.
And Skip has seen enough. He's going to go now to his veteran Travis Duke in the bullpen. He got to get someone in there right now that can throw strikes, and Travis Duke has been able to do that.
That'll be it for Shem. Strikeout and two walks. He is responsible for Straub at second and Tulia at first with the two walks. Teaching moment here.
Yeah, Skip having a moment with the young kid. A lot of times Skip will get on just trying to do too much, trying to throw too hard. Skip's not afraid. He'll get up in your face in a heartbeat. sometimes, in like Michael Cantu or Tres Barrera behind the plate, he has to know the attitudes as well. Who can he get on? Who can he not?
Well, as Travis gets loose, 2015 Longhorns seem to be trending upward after a great run in the College World Series. We asked the team about their goals for the upcoming season.
I mean, obviously the team goals for a national championship. That's what we came here to do. When you come here as a freshman, they preach that to you, and that's what I'm looking forward to this year, and hopefully we get it.
We really want to win the Big 12, so that's the first goal, and then we won the national championship.
Not only to get there, but to win it all. We were so close. Left a little bitter taste in our mouth, but we'll be back.
Just take it one day at a time and win the day, because baseball's a grind, it's a marathon, so you got to break it down, and the best way to do that is day by day.
Yeah. John Bible.
We're having a good time out
there. Been doing this for 40 years. You got to have a good time during pitching breaks. So having fun with the Texas infielders. But, yeah, the goal is you finish third. You could tell these guys got the taste, and now you would think the hardest part is getting the program back to the College World Series. Now they want to get back and win number seven.
It does leave a bad taste. Because, like I said, I think the expectations – yeah, you want to come here, you want to make it to Omaha, but the team really wasn't expected to do that last year, and they overachieved. They made it to Omaha, and when you do that and you develop as a team and you get that taste and you get, I mean, they were 80 feet away from making it almost to the championship series on the ground ball, the weak ground ball by Vanderbilt. You would rather the guy hit it 400 feet out of the park than something like that. That's the taste that they're feeling right now, and it's good because it will drive you the next year. It'll drive you in the fall that they already went through, and now for this season, the taste is there, and they want to taste the other side of it.
Yeah, I would have paid you $1 million that I don't have if you would have seen a 400-foot ball leave Omaha last year.
A few weeks later.
Right, exactly.
In the Home Run Derby.
So Duke comes on to face Skylar Valentine, who has the only ribby for UTSA, back in the fourth inning. Travis Duke has just been phenomenal in his career at Texas. Not going to light up any radar guns. This is 2-0. Valentine, a true freshman. That's in there for a strike. Travis, seemed like he got hit a little more than he usually does in Houston. You see anything different?
He has been struggling a little bit with mechanic-wise. And confidence-wise, because when you have the year he had last year, what, he gave up one run the entire season. And then in the fall, he struggled a little bit. Over the summer, he struggled a little bit. Just mechanical-wise.
Right. Double there. Steal, and that's going to pay off. Coming home to score, the second run is Straub, and it's 3-2. Nice day for Skylar Valentine.
You don't see that too often. Double steal. Runners on second and third, and a double steal hit. Just a hitter swinging at it. Just the element of surprise. CJ had to go to cover second base. That took him out of position a little bit.
Not sure if he would have applied, but.
No. He could have. I mean, in the hole, he might have been able to go to third with it.
True. Gonna have a pinch runner. Logan Kinder's gonna come out. Logan's from Leander, went to Rouse High School. Get some speed as the tying run at second. CJ Pickering, who's 0-for-2, grounded out, also flied out. Low. will be charged to Tyler Shemp. Five hits now for UTSA, seven for Texas. Longhorns have committed an error.
Travis Duke made the pitch to Valentine. The runners were in motion. Jason Marshall, the head coach for the Roadrunners, trying to press the issue. It worked. Got a run home. Now you still have runners on first and second, one out.
Tipped into the mitt.
See if he decides to do it again. Worked once.
You don't see that a lot.
See, now it's in the back of the mind of the Longhorns, taking Travis Duke out of his rhythm a little bit. He's going to get his signs from Brooks Marlowe. Could be an attempted pickoff.
Brooks is staying close over there and giving Duke signs.
There are different signs for one look, two looks, no looks, fake throw or throw. So now what UTSA is doing is taking Travis Duke out of his rhythm. He needs to get his thoughts back on the hitter in the box, CJ Pickering.
Maybe what his freshman catcher is telling him. You're a ground ball away from getting out of the inning. Roadrunners have definitely taken Texas out of their rhythm.
Long look down there by Pickering, the third base coach.
UTSA fans that are in attendance making some noise.
I know you worry about the runner, but this is kind of taking it to an extreme this at bat.
2-1, runners do take off. This is lifted. And Cantu will make the play. Once again, the runner's taking off.
They're trying to press the issue.
Does Trace maybe need to call him off here? Trace hadn't played a lot of firsts.
It is a tougher play for the catcher because the ball is coming back towards the infield. It's coming right back towards Tres Barrera right here, but he really didn't look like he wanted much part of that pop fly right there. Wasn't coming after it very hard. So a good play by Michael Cantu to reach out there with the one hand.
Well, you're competing for a catching job. You want to make sure he doesn't look as good, you know?
Right. Well, I guess all the looks at second and everything paid off, and Travis Duke able to keep his composure right there, get the second out of the inning.
Not out of it, though. Giante Jackson singled his last time up. Lifts this in foul territory. Coming in is Shaw, and what an amazing play! Collin Shaw dives! As the ball was coming back into play. Wow. That's why he's playing right field.
Yeah, that was amazing. That was Collin Shaw at his finest right here. Finds the ball right at the end. Look at that leap and grab. Third out of the innings. Horns keep the lead 3-2.
Good sportsmanship out here. Psych. Now watch the UTSA Roadrunner. You got to get a kick out of that.
Yeah, he did.
That was some of the fun things off of the field. On the field, Collin Shaw making another highlight catch here. Ball blowing back in.
He had to run the furthest for the ball. Tres Barrera's not going to get there. Right at the last minute, Collin Shaw just reaches out. We've seen it done many times. But this one, I think, could be one of the better ones. I mean, look at full extension. We've seen him do it in left field. We've seen him do it in right field.
Snow cone in it.
Stayed in that glove. Wow, what a play. I mean, nothing really amazes you. I mean, when he does it night in and night out. We saw him already dive almost over the fence in right field for a foul ball. That play right there was unbelievable.
Gerwitz will lead off. Shaw scheduled to hit third. Texas with a 3-2 lead here in the bottom of the sixth inning. Well, Shaw made a play a couple years ago in Minnesota at the Metrodome in left field, laying out in foul territory. And Augie said in his now 47 years that it's one of the best catches he's ever seen.
Yeah, he made that one. I think the one last year in Norman in Oklahoma in right center, diving towards the fence, the wall in right center.
Landing on the track, too.
Yeah.
He's one heck of an athlete, you know, putting the baseball skill with it.
Let's see if the Longhorn offense can feed off that little momentum right here.
Try and get that run back that the Roadrunners got in the top half. UTSA scored in the fourth inning, and Texas answered with a run. This is charged towards center on the run. And showing that speed is Markham. We told you he can fly, and he's talking some noise now.
No, it's all about the jump. You see him right there. He just glides to the ball. Right here, ball driven. He's playing right about a little over shaded to right, but just like runs under like it's nothing. Oh, he's taking a little bit from the bus out there in right field and lets him know about it, too.
That's fair game.
He made that look pretty easy.
Top of the order, Ben Johnson. Ben doubled, got an RBI. His last time up in the fourth, he's 1-for-3. Ball he hit really took off.
It did. You see Markham now out there in center field, just a little bit deeper than he was last time Ben was up. Now he moves back in.
Well, Markham was lucky that Cantu was ahead of Johnson on the base pass, because Ben, once he hit that, you looked at me and you thought, this could be four.
Oh, yeah. But a good job by Markham getting to the ball. The ball didn't even make it to the warning track. Ran it down real quick and made it a close play at home plate on Cantu.
I don't care if he runs a 6.460 or not. If he's close to that, that's flying. And you add in that jump, it's pretty good center fielder. 2-2 now.
Well, he's a good-looking athlete, good-looking player. I mean, sometimes center fielders at the next level, they don't have to be too big. As long as you run down balls like that, you're going to play this game a lot.
They sit to right field for Ben Johnson, his second hit of the night. One out base runner for Texas.
Check out Ben Johnson. Gets that stride. Gets out in front just slightly, but hands stayed back. Very important. You can be fooled out on your front side, but as long as your hands stay back, they did. He's able to drive it through the hole on the ground. I'd like to see Texas get aggressive, too. I know there's one out and there's a lefty on the mound, but Ben Johnson needs to use that speed.
Quick meeting at the mound.
Keep an eye on that runner at first base. We've seen a lot of breaking balls to left-handers from Sepsic tonight. Perfect opportunity for Ben Johnson to try to get a bag.
Coach Marshall looking down at his bullpen there. Some activity. Guys are trying to get loose.
I think he was be getting ready for CJ on deck. Got a lefty-lefty matchup you want right here.
Brandon Savage.
Bunt, and it's a good one. This is going to be a tough play. Throw to first, not in time. Base hit bunt for Collin Shaw.
Thank you, Goodall.
That was the same situation you said earlier with Boswell. Third baseman back a little bit, lefty-lefty. Perfect situation.
Perfect situation. Tough. Sometimes the curveball is tough to bunt because it has the spin. It's going away from the lefty, but Collin Shaw stayed in there with it. Good speed down the line.
Great speed on the base paths as Shaw is at first. You've got Ben Johnson at second after Collin picked up his second hit of the evening.
Might get a visit from Borman here or someone, I would imagine. You want that right-hander to face CJ.
CJ's had a good night. He's one for two and scored a run. Also picked up a walk.
Yep. Just buying a little time, I would think.
Yeah, but you wouldn't buy time on the mound if it means you're going to be leaving the mound, right?
Well, if you get the sign to hold.
If you ever want to see the mound again, right? Well,
another one. Gives you two more pitches in the bullpen. Not rushing too much down there, though.
No.
So what kind of other moves can we do here? Yep.
Yeah.
Borman will go to the mound.
For all you checking out the baseball game, wondering about the basketball game, Texas leading Oklahoma 32-30 with about 3 minutes to go in the first half. Texas looking a lot better in the first half than they did against the Sooners here in Austin. And now,
here we go.
Coach Marshall's going to come out. Good call there, Greg.
It was pretty obvious there, Kev.
I know.
At least you can jog out there.
This is like a Gus walk. He is taking his time. Don't forget, Texas soccer is back as super goalie Abby Smith leads the Horns in an exhibition match against Monterey Tech. The action kicks off at 7 Central on Longhorn Network. You can also check it out at Watch ESPN.
I can see why it might be taking Nolan Savage a little longer. He's a hard thrower. Sometimes it takes you
warm up
a few more pitches to get that fastball where you want it.
Where do you expect to see his fastball hitting around?
Around 94, 95 miles an hour.
It's bringing it.
Sometimes in this cooler weather, it takes you a few extra pitches. Marshall knows that. Now he's got his right-hander in to face C.J. Hinojosa.
After his lefty gave him a couple extra tosses in the bullpen. Big spot here. Texas trying to answer that one run in the sixth. Two guys with speed, two in Ben Johnson and Collin Shaw, and got the heart of the order up.
CJ's a good fastball hitter.
Oh, and a junior from Lubbock. We take a look at this Texas team and what we've seen so far through the first four games and now here tonight. What's your thought on the offense going to be more dynamic this year?
They're gritty. That's how I'm going to put it. Gritty. They didn't get a lot of hits in Houston against Rice, but they scored some runs. Tonight they've done the same thing. They got 9 hits, only the 3 to show for it, but they're gritty. They're taking good at-bats. We talked about the number of pitches per at-bat. They've been doing that well. Put together a couple rallies tonight. Right now is another situation where you got a guy who hit the ball well in Houston, didn't get many hits, but hit the ball well. He's had good at-bats tonight. So I'm going with the word gritty.
With a chance to grow.
Yes.
The starting pitching, though, would be something that you said earlier. Usually that's something that's taken care of here on the 40, but something that Skip feels like he has the arms. He's got to find out which ones.
You got to find out which ones. I know nerves took over for the pitchers on Saturday. Casey Clemens making his first college start at home in Houston. A little nervy. Josh Sawyer making his first college start.
Mm-hmm.
And it was in Houston. So give those guys a couple more starts. They'll settle down. I've seen it out of them in inter-squad, so you know the ability is there. It's just a matter of putting it all together and not letting the nerves take over.
So here's CJ. CJ singled back in the first inning, walked and scored in the third, then grounded out to the pitcher in the fourth inning. Ben Johnson is at second. Collin Shaw at first. Is Augie go Coach Marshall here and try and double steal?
He's going to let CJ hit this fastball right here. If they try to steal, it'll be on their own. I'm sure Ben Johnson has a green light whenever he wants it. They're both very smart base runners. It took a while for Ben Johnson to learn how to become a good base runner. I remember a few times his freshman year, he was getting thrown out in situations and picked off. But he's really become one of the better base stealers in college baseball.
All right, that's looking good, Savage.
There's a fastball right there at 92. He fouls away. Texas is 1-for-10 with runners in scoring position tonight. Pretty smooth for 93.
It is very smooth. Right here, CJ should get another smooth one. See if he can put a real nice swing on this one. He likes to hit the fastball. He always has an approach. Get that fastball and drive one out to right center.
Goes to right. Valentine will make the play at first. Both runners advance, and there's two outs. Johnson third, Shaw at second, and it's up to Brooks Marlowe. Marlowe still looking for his first hit.
Fastballs so far from Savage. Sometimes it's tough to get a feel for a breaking ball in cooler weather when you're a hard thrower. Texas look for
it's underneath this, and coming in will be the center fielder Markham. Makes the play, and Texas strands a couple. We played six Longhorns by one.
Your heart.
Tonight's game summary, it is powered by the new Chevy Silverado. Take a look at Texas being led by Tres Barrera, 2-for-3, has two RBI. Skylar Valentine's done the job for UTSA as he's knocked in a couple, also stolen a base, and all in all, it's been pretty good baseball.
Pretty good baseball. Texas at 1-for-12 with runners in scoring a position. Really good. They could have put this game away, but UTSA Roadrunner pitching has done a good job with the runners in scoring position against the Longhorns.
Trent Bowles to face Travis Duke, who's out for his first full inning of work. It seems to be the key with Duke, and it seems to happen a lot. First pitch strikes.
Sometimes when he comes in out of the pen, a lot of times he's not completely ready. And that gets him in a little bit of trouble, but not too much. It seems like next the second inning, he starts to settle down. He's able to get out of last inning, though, helped out by that great play by Collin Shaw. And right now, up 0-2 on Bowles.
And two. Matty couldn't squeeze that.
That's one thing when you're not a hard thrower, you really have to locate. And that's part of Travis, why he's been getting in trouble or get hit a little bit, because he hasn't located very well. That ball down in the zone, good changeup.
Right back to him. Pretty easy out, the first out. I'll turn it over. Bring up Kevin Markham. An impressive athlete. You've seen that out in center field. He's got some power, too. He's a guy who's originally from Willis, Texas, went to North Central Junior College. It was a good find for Coach Marshall. Brett Boswell. I think he learned his lesson this time with Markham in that 6'4", 60. He got rid of it quickly.
You learn the speed of your opponent very quick. Boswell gets to it. See the smile right there. Good play. Another calm, collected, got to it. Feet work, footwork, gets rid of it quick.
Two quick outs for Matt Hilston. Hilston looking for his first hit. He's had a rough night. He struck out in the first, hit into a 4-6-3 double play in the third, then flied out to center back in the fifth inning. This guy Coach Marshall really likes, though. Just a solid, steady player. Down the bunt. That's a nice one. That's going to be a base hit. Is Barrera able to at least get a glove on it? That may be a ball you don't want to throw if you're Duke. Just eat it.
When you're a pitcher and you get off that mound, you have to slide to get the ball. You might get me or you, but you're not going to get a runner like Hilson going down.
You're not going to get a D1 athlete. Current D1 athlete. You were.
I mean, a great attempt by Travis Duke. Maybe ill-advised throw.
Two outs, and we'll bring up John Borman.
Jake McKenzie, I believe, in the pen. He's ready. Let's see if they decide to stick with Travis Duke here.
Borman looking for his first hit. Okay. Having an excellent opening weekend against the Raging Cajuns, including two home runs. Hosa to first, couldn't make the play, but an excellent effort by CJ. CJ's down. Just tweak something.
Great effort. We talked about the speed and the quickness that CJ has since his freshman year. I believe right there might have knocked the wind out of him a little bit. He landed pretty hard. Right there, does a good job of getting up too deep up the middle to get Borman.
That'll be a hit. First one for Borman. Tying run at second base. Tyler Straub walked and scored last inning. Kevin Dunn, Keith Moreland, Augie Garrido, watching intently.
Taking it all in. Gonna go out now. Travis Duke will not like it, but Skip Johnson probably gonna go to his right-hander, Jake McKenzie, right here to get the right-hander.
Saw him say that a boy, Travis. as we are going to see the freshman with the highly touted slider. We'll give you more on Jake McKenzie when we get back. Texas leading 3-2. Welcome back. Your new pitcher for Texas is Jake McKenzie, a 6-foot, 168-pounder. He's a freshman from Dallas, Texas, went to W.T. White High School. He's a guy who can play the infield and also pitch. What does he have on the mound?
He's got good stuff on the mound. Comes right after you with a good fastball, and you've got an exceptional slider. Like you said, a two-way guy, played some third base earlier last weekend at Rice, pitched a little bit. He's going to give you all he has. He's very competitive when he's on the mound. Another one of those guys that Skip Johnson likes to see out there.
He also played some third base. Augie really likes his mentality. He seems to be a bulldog. We'll see what he can do here on the mound. You mentioned the slider. What else are we going to see from him?
Good fastball. A fastball slider pitcher. Keep the ball down, not overpowering. 87, 88 mile an hour fastball, but he has a good slider.
Tyler Straub. He's at the plate. Tyler is 0 for 2. Walked and scored his last time up. See that slider pretty quickly.
Right there. Well, you're a new pitcher coming into the game. There's runner in scoring position, a tying run in scoring position. You expect the hitter to be aggressive. A good pitch by McKenzie, even though it was a ball.
Second. Marlowe will take it himself. And McKenzie comes on, a couple pitches, and the Roadrunners strand a couple. Seventh inning stretch time. We're going to go ahead and hang out here at the dish. Longhorns with that 3-2 lead out hit UTSA 9-7. Well, one of the new guys for Texas the last couple years has been Tommy Nicholson, who came in to take over for Tommy Harmon. Tommy knows all about the 40, playing second base here, and now is coaching third base.
Generally, if you're a left-handed hitter, that first baseman is going to be playing back. So if you're more comfortable going, and I always was more comfortable taking it with me. Come on.
I hit that ball hard right back to him.
That's why I missed it.
I know.
You got one out. Make sure you know where the outfield is.
Gotcha. It's fast.
Huh? Center fielder throws pretty well. Left fielder threw all right. Okay in the outfield. Come on, CJ, come on. Yes. Come on, Michael, come on. Yes, you gotta go.
Keeping Austin wired with Tommy Nicholson. He's done a great job on the recruiting path and also has done a nice job with the infielders. But you look at him coaching third. I like him getting after Ken, too. You can almost hear him trying to push him down the line.
He was yelling at Michael before he stepped on second base.
Come on, Michael.
You got to get on. The runner, because they're depending on you. They can hear the inflection in your voice. You know, if it gets louder and it gets, you know, like, that means hurry up. Get on your horse. Let's go.
If you were playing, what would you like about playing for a guy like Tommy Nicholson?
Well, he's a gamer. I mean, the guy gets out there, he practices with you, he's on the field with you every day, he's into his craft, he's coaching well. You saw right there helping Collin Shaw, left-handed hitter, against a left-handed pitcher. He said, well, I felt comfortable taking the ball with me, meaning a bunt. So it's whatever you're comfortable with. So he's always into the game, helping everyone out. He's good to be around. It's probably the most we've heard him talk in a long time, but he's doing a great job down there in third base coach's box.
Tres Barrera is going to lead it off for Texas. This could be a swinging bunt. Bare hand, the throw, safe. Wasn't exactly Calvin Murray getting down the line, but Trace with a big smile, and he'll take the hit.
That ball gets in on Trace. See the third baseman Pickering rounded the ball to get a good fielding, position. See him go around it here to the left. So he's able to pick it up with that bare hand. But the speed right there of Tres Barrera. It's a good knock.
That'll bring up Brett Boswell. Pickering at third, already looking for a bunt. So he's playing in. Well, one thing with Savage, he's thrown nothing but fastballs. You would think this would be an easier pitch to bunt, as long as it's not a fastball letter high.
Never easy to bunt, especially a hard-throwing pitcher. I'm just about to say that since he has thrown all fastballs, it might be a good time to let Brett Boswell swing the bat. And there, he wasn't going to square around. I wouldn't think he would 2-0 either.
To the right side, gets underneath Valentine. Barrera will stop at second, but Texas with something cooking here in the seventh. We'll go down as a hit.
It's one of those ground balls hit hard that gets through the infield. It's hard to make the assumption again that with the older ball, it wouldn't have got through, but that ball was hit pretty good on the ground. And
yeah.
Finds the hole.
We'll see if the true freshman Michael McCann is going to bunt. Texas 1-for-12 with runners in scoring position tonight. Squares early. There's a lot of stuff going on there. The wheel was on. We had third crashing, short heading to third, and Nolan didn't want to throw it.
I think again, the seeing if McCann was going to square around. He never
squared
around.
To.
He started to a little bit. See if that happens again. But hitters usually has liberty to do the old butcher boy and slash one up the middle.
Well, they changed it up this time as they decided to go ahead and crash Jackson and keep Pickering back at third.
And Savage throws the breaking ball. A lot happening right now. Out there and discuss some defensive strategy right now. You would think with Barrera on second base, you would do the crash play and try to get him at third. He's already used a lot of energy getting down to first base and then running to second base. Augie as well will have a visit with Michael McCann. I would think if he sees the wheel play on, that he would be able to swing the bat. Because in that situation, you just put anything up the middle. The middle of the infield is going to be wide open.
Wide open, yeah. McCann with a double tonight. His last time up. Ripped one down the left field line. Very reminiscent of the ball he hit Sunday at Recklin. In the 10th inning, to give Texas a 4-3 lead. They end up winning that thing 4-3. Jackson going to crash from first again. The bunt is popped up and a diving play. What a play by the big man Savage getting off the mound.
Very good play. They're going to break towards third base. But right there, the ball's up in the air. He's just going to stretch completely out and catch that one. Longhorn runners alertly getting back to the bag, so there could have been a possibility of at least a double play right there.
So here's Michael Cantu. Stopped by Borman.
Tres sometimes thinks he has more speed than he really does. I mean, the aggressiveness of seeing the ball in the dirt right there, he was halfway down to third base.
Oh, if you're not blessed with the speed that you and other people were, you got to get the jump.
You have to.
Just missed. This almost takes me back to Shimp. When you're not hitting your spots, you're not going to get calls.
Yeah. Yeah, tonight, it seemed that's been really apparent.
A little lower, but he gets that one. Catches the bottom of the zone.
Nice downhill fastball by Savage. Good velocity, good location. played his position well in the last play.
Three and one, it's a fastball count, but you know you're gonna get a fastball anyway.
Yeah, you can't. Looking there with a sign from Augie Garrido. Young freshman, sometimes you would have him take right here, and then you have the 3-2 count. You know you're probably gonna see a fastball. Some things gonna let him swing it. Good at bat.
Bases are loaded. We do have an update from Norman. Oklahoma leads Texas. Actually, they lead them 37-34 right now. That game currently on ESPN2. Texas baseball here. A chance to break it open here. And
well, they've had the opportunities.
They have. I'll bring up Zane Gerwitz. Zane 0-for-2 with the sack back in the second. Nice movement, catches his own. Texas is 1-for-5 with the bases loaded on the season, 0-for-1 today. Comes back with a breaking ball and hung it.
Runners in scoring position. Runs on the line right here.
That's the second breaking ball we've seen, right?
Yes.
0-2. Got him to chase. Good morning, good afternoon, good night. Gerwitz is down on strikes.
Savage bearing down right there, two straight. Breaking balls to Zane Gerwitz out of the zone. Zane just trying to do too much, not seeing the ball.
Texas is 0-for-12 runners in scoring position since Tres Barrera had that first inning single. It's up to Ben Johnson. He's had a good night, 2-for-4 off to a torrid start. And all of a sudden he's come back with this now a bunch. He's found it
all of a sudden, huh?
Well, you've mentioned that a lot. You can just lose it and find it out there, and if you find it, go with it.
Well, it's good catchers, good pitchers. You make the adjustment. He's missing with a fastball, but he's starting to find the zone with that breaking ball. Now the fastball, that was a good running fastball into Ben Johnson. Now you have the upper hand, showing that you can get that breaking ball over the plate.
Fastball's had some more run the last couple pitches. One ball, one strike, two outs. Bases loaded here in the bottom of the seventh. Back up the middle, base hit. One run is in. And this is going to get past the center fielder, Markham. Ben Johnson rounding third. He's coming in. Four in for the Horns, and they've blown it open.
Too aggressive right there. He's going to come in, try to throw the runner out at home plate, takes his eye off the ball just enough. Love them get on the ground. You see right here, good job by Ben Johnson, though, driving a breaking ball right back up the middle. You see right here, he's going to look up just a little bit, and now he knows with the speed of Ben Johnson, even though he does have a 6'4", 60, he's not going to be able to get to it by the time Ben Johnson gets around the bases.
Well, he knew the guy who hit the ball is a 6'4", 6'5", 60 guy.
Right. So Longhorns with a big break right there.
Well, two would have been in.
So right there. Looks like it might have taken a little funny hop on him because he had his glove down and then it just moved over to the side. Ben Johnson with a Little League grand slam.
Well, Brett Boswell runs pretty well. I don't think.
I would say two RBIs right there.
Right, that Markham was going to have a shot, but those two extra runs. Gigantic.
Yeah, at a point in the game where it was one pitch away from keeping it at a one-run game. And tip your hat to Ben Johnson after Zane Gerwitz had chased a couple of sliders. Ben Johnson saw the same one and hit one right there. Stayed with it right back up the middle.
Savage had found that slider. We hadn't seen really anything but a fastball. But he hung it a little too much, and we saw him get a little too much of the plate.
Over the middle of the plate, the ones to Zane Gerwitz were away, unhittable. That one to Ben was just right over the middle of the plate. What a night after going 0-for-2 for Ben Johnson to come back with three straight hits, three RBIs. His last three at-bats.
Not bad. And it's worth the price of admission just to watch him run around the base paths. That was fun.
Well, you knew, I mean, from our angle, it got by Markham, yeah. I mean, it's, as far as it had to go, that Ben was, he was almost to second base. And when he saw the ball go through the glove, it was just a matter of how quick he was going to get it around home.
Once you saw that, you saw a gear go from about 3 to 6 pretty quickly. It's a tough break for Markham. He's a heck of an athlete, and he's going to be a fun guy to watch in that conference and in this state this year. But that athlete will take it. Do have a new pitcher, Trent Rossipel. Rossipel is from Austin. Big moment for him to come in here. Trent went to Cedar Ridge High School, so he is very familiar with Michael McCann. I'm sure, yes, McCann's giving the scouting report right now on the bench, right?
Scouting report right here.
Collin Shaw's at the plate. Collins 2-for-3, a couple singles, was hit by a pitch, scored a run, but his best play was in right field. Just a diving effort. It's three guys, Brooks, Marlowe, and Tres Barrera, all trying to find the ball in that no man's land.
He's fun to watch. I mean, you never know what he's going to do in the outfield.
Yeah.
Very good athlete. Literally saw him almost run through a wall tonight for you. If you're pitching, you love that. If you're on his team, you love that.
Yeah, when you tell guys run through a wall, you didn't really mean that. Right. 2-2. Fought that off. Texas with the four spot here to really break it open.
Well, nice job after going 0-for-12 since the first inning with runners in scoring position. That was a huge hit, even though four came in. The two that did come in before the error would have been.
It's a short. Shaw runs well. It's going to be a tough play, and he beat it out. Now, Straub had a funky hop and some funky spin on that, had to backhand it, and you got a guy like Collin Shaw, you don't have much time.
Yeah, kind of looked like that Vanderbilt hit right there.
Yeah.
I mean, not hit hard enough to get off the infield grass, which here is the turf. That's all you can do with it. Grab it, exchange from glove to hand, and get rid of it. It's probably a good job.
But once he had to backhand it.
Yeah. And the little extra half step that he took.
Third hit for Collin Shaw. Collin's going to take off. Throw down there. Got him. Nice throw from Borman. You can see why he was drafted in the 19th round. He's got a nice future ahead of him. So does Ben Johnson. Johnson opening up the game with a little help from Markham. Bring it home, Ben. Texas leads. Texas took on the Minnesota Gophers at the Dome.
They face a second-round pick. Tom Wendell is in Double-A with the Dodgers right now, tearing it up. Texas saw how good his stuff was. Alex Silver helping out in game number two. This is going to be a close one. This is like Tommy Nicholson. Texas wins it in 10, 5-4. Weston Hall was the star in game three. Weston had a couple hits, including that one. Three hits, actually. Texas goes on to win 6-3 to take the series. Make sure you tune into LHN this weekend as the sixth-ranked Texas baseball team will take on Minnesota right here at the Dish for a four-game weekend series. Game one of that set will begin at 6 Central on Friday. You can see all those games right here on Longhorn Network or watch ESPN. Minnesota went to Houston this weekend to take on the Cougars, top 10 team, and got swept. Felt like they got some pretty good experience. They lost 9-1, 5-0, and 5-4, so a couple of those, certainly the last one, they were competitive. We'll see what they bring down here. Kinder's come on to hit here. Logan came on to pinch run. Sophomore from the area, from Leander, Texas, went to Rouse High School. Jake McKenzie on for his first full inning.
Good job he did coming in last inning. UTSA had a couple base runners on. Jake comes in, throws a couple pitches, gets the third out of the inning. And then look what happened after that. Horton put up a four spot to pretty much blow this thing open right now at this point. Eighth inning.
You could really feel the air come out of that UTSA bench. There's a strikeout from McKenzie. Augie really likes this kid.
Well, he's I say the word a lot, competitive. When we're at this level, we have a kid that's just going to go out there and give it everything he has, whether he's at third base, shortstop, pitching. I mean, that's a frisbee type slider right there. And it's tough to pick up.
Well, those change planes too.
See how he throws that front shoulder out there, front elbow out there, kind of hides it. And then all of a sudden it gets on you. And he's got a pretty decent fastball, but that breaking ball is nasty right there.
Two talented freshmen here. Skylar Valentine's a freshman. He's had the only two ribbies for UTSA on two singles. He's a good-looking young player. And you get 0-2 and you throw it way out.
Waste right? One. Maybe a little too wasted right there.
Trying to hit the mascot.
He'll come back with it closer right here.
Thought about offering, lays on. Coach Marshall talking about Valentine before the game. He said this was one of the guys that we really need to get for the future of this program, but he really feels like the four or five freshmen, with Valentine being at the top of the list, are going to have a bright future for this program. Cantu dropped it, but Wiley rung him up anyway.
Back-to-back strikeouts by Jake McKenzie. This one, this time the slider stayed inside on Valentine. See right here, kind of hung out right there. David Wiley gives it to him.
I think Skyler thought that may have been a little inside, but that's not his call. Two outs here. Skip Johnson and Augie look on. He's been starting a lot of guys off with that little frisbee.
Sometimes pitchers have better feel for their breaking ball. Jacob McKenzie is one of those. You pitch not backwards for you, for yourself, being Jake McKenzie. He pitches like a normal pitcher would throw a fastball.
Mm-hmm.
He uses his breaking ball. I guess some people call that pitching backwards. But then when you have the best feel for that pitch, why not throw it the most? And then just waste your fastball like you will right here.
Pitching backwards is just like saying something's normal. Well, what's normal? Yeah. Normal to you, right? Like, it's right. Normal. Pitching regularly is to go fastball and then finish him with a breaking ball.
But he has a good fastball. He showed right there.
1-2, sky high. Cantu's going to take it and try to one-hand another one, and this time he can't make the play.
That could very easily go down as an E2. A little bit hard play. It's twice tonight. You're right. He looks down to Tres. See, he's not going to get there. And goes up with the one hand.
And both of them, he's really had to lean back. This ball, you always say it, it's going to come back
regardless of whether there's wind, which is not tonight. But when the wind is blowing, it's a foul ball to the catcher is always going to come back towards the playing field. And he was looking at Tres right there, and I think Jake McKenzie, I thought he might call him off. He's an infielder.
Read my mind. I was waiting for him to call him off. And Hosa will range to his left. A strong throw, and it's a moot point. McKenzie comes in. 1-2-3. We go to the bottom of the eighth. Welcome back. Take a look at I-35 and the dish behind it. Lit up, ready for another season. The 40th season here. It's the 40th anniversary to this day that Texas opened it up as we take a look at Conference USA and where UTSA fits in. This is the preseason poll. The Roadrunners were picked to finish fifth. Then you go and take two out of three. That was at home, but against Louisiana Lafayette. Obviously, Rice is the team to beat. I think Texas found out why this weekend.
Yeah, Rice is a very good team. Unanimous right there. 12 votes. UTSA, they have a bright future in that conference. They're a good team, coached well all around.
That's a pretty good conference. FIU, Old Dominion. Playing some pretty good baseball there.
Right up the road.
Yeah, right. And they played pretty good baseball for most of the time tonight. Texas maybe trying to get a little insurance as it'll be 3, 4, and 5 for Texas here in the eighth. C.J. Hinojosa, Brooks Marlowe, and Tres Barrera are scheduled to hit. This is going to be a tough play, and it's going to fall in for a base hit. CJ's going to round first. Here comes the throw to second, and Hinojosa just in with a double. Well, after you've laced 7 or 8 balls that were right at people, you will take that.
The law of averages. This one right here floats just in the perfect spot. CJ recognizes it out of the box. What's this? He's going to see it. All right, that ball's going to drop. I can get two right here. Nonstop. Hesitated just slightly. Maybe a close play down there at second base.
Good slide to go to the other part of the bag and hook it with his hand. CJ with his second hit, 2 for 4 now, and that'll bring up Marlowe. Texas 1-3 hitters are now 8 for 13. Marlowe still looking for that first hit. 3 fly balls and a line out. Kevin Dunn, Greg Swindell here at Dish Falk Field. 2015 season opener here at the Dish for Texas. Another 4 strike.
Texas doing a good job with the 14 hits tonight. Good to see, especially from the top of that order, like you said. Lots of hits, lots of runs.
Texas has also been very good when it counts. It counts even more in the latter part of the game. Outscoring opponents 14-1 from the seventh on.
Quite a change from 17 strikeouts last game to just 4 tonight.
Yeah. Texas had 42 strikeouts in the 4 games coming into tonight. This is to right center. It's going to be a base hit. CJ had to wait to see if Valentine could make a play, so runners are on the corners with nobody out. First hit for Marlowe. And now 15 hits for Texas on the night.
Brooks didn't jam a little bit, got in on him, but another hit off the left hand.
He had 3 hits off of left-handers 2 years ago. Did much better last season. Really seeing a lot of maturation from the senior from Giddings, Texas.
See, even with the composite bat, his hands are still ringing a little bit from getting jammed right there. can imagine what that would feel like with a wooden bat.
Here's Barrera. He's had a nice night.
A real nice
night. This ball is drilled to left. Forget about it. A three-run bomb from Tres Barrera. A no-doubter. Yes, the ball is flying further. Guess he's got to eat, huh?
Fourth hit, five RBIs. This one left the bat. Just had enough distance. That man's going to hit a few home runs this year and in his career. The ball took off. He knew it had the distance. Not an easy night to hit home runs.
No. All four hits for Barrera came on the first pitch. He's been up there looking for something.
Dan Barrera has 4 for 5 with 5 RBI. Wow.
Texas blown this thing wide open now. Brett Boswell is at the plate. Four hits for Barrera, 5 knocked in. Got a bright future ahead of him. Fastball for a strike, 1-2.
This is a one-run game last inning.
It was. And it's one of the
intense
things.
Intense one-run game.
It was. One of the things, though, I think that you've talked about and the coaching staff has talked about, this offense is going to be better. The talent is just there.
Yeah, and Augie has the approach. They have the mental approach. They did it all weekend at Rice. Just came up short a couple games. But tonight, I mean, it's 16 hits, 10 runs. That was unheard of a couple years ago. That one just gets away from Rossipal. Borman saying, now you know what it almost feels like. That was close right there. Puts it in perspective when you see it from that angle.
Yeah.
I mean, that ball missed him by, I mean, an inch.
Well, and it's tailing in.
Yes. So what do you do right here? Breaking ball?
No, I don't dig in. Oh, you're talking about if you're at the plate. Boswell will take the walk. Here's what the box scores look like. Man, this looks completely different from the last couple of years. 3 for 5, 3 for 4, 2 for 4, 1 for 5, 4 for 5, all the way down. And Zane Gerwitz is 0 for 3. Does have a positive at-bat with a sack, though.
Always happens, though. Whenever there's a lot of hits, there's always that one guy.
Yeah. How come he couldn't have had one of Trace's, right? Here's Michael. McCann doubled. He's back in the fifth inning. He's a good-looking young hitter. Some other guys maybe that Texas fans are curious about that they've not seen tonight we can talk about. Taylor Stell is a guy who played some in center. Seems like Taylor has come on a little bit.
He's healthy.
He's healthy, which is a huge part. To left center. This is going to get in. Boswell will stop at second. And another hit for McCann. Now 17 hits on the night for Texas.
Get a fastball up in the zone. Michael McCann likes that pitch. We've got this one. Hits it in the left center for his second hit.
Another guy that Augie's talked about is Patrick Mathis. We expect to see Mathis at some point. He's a left-handed hitter, a freshman. You mentioned Travis Jones, who started at first base. A lot of options for Augie this season.
And that's the good thing. And a lot of them played in the series at Rice. A lot of them will play this weekend against Minnesota. A lot of them are going to get playing time. So you're going to have options, not just your starting nine that you put out there. You can have confidence that you have a bench that you can rely on.
Rossipal is going to be done. That was his first career college outing in his hometown against a number 6 team in the country. That's not easy at all. He's going to have better days than that one as he faced 6 batters only out. Where he gave up 3 singles and a double. Also, the home run.
Just gave up a base hit to his teammate last year.
Yep.
Right there.
Well, and that's what we had talked about. He's from Cedar Ridge, and McCann it had to feel good for Michael, but he also had a pretty good read on him. Although, I guess on the flip side, he would have been thrown to Michael a lot, so Ross knows about him. So Ross pulls done, and UTSA just trying to get out of the eighth here without giving up any more damage. Dylan Turney will be the new pitcher. Update from Norman, Texas leading Oklahoma 55-51 right now. That's currently on ESPN2. Longhorns, that would be a big one for them. 6.5 minutes remaining as we try and finish things off here in Austin. Nice offensive performance. Longhorns with 4 in the bottom of the 7th and 3 here in the bottom of the 8th. Still nobody out, runners on first and second. As we look at Turney, a freshman from Richmond, Texas. A lot of freshmen on both teams getting action.
A lot of action going on with the young players. It makes me think now, you have an 8-run lead. Kyle Johnston was supposed to pitch tonight. I wonder if they would still bring him in an 8-run game. There's no one warming up at the time, but there's no outs. There's still time to continue to get loose. I think you might want to run him back out there and see what he has. Jake McKenzie is also throwing the ball well, and you do have an 8-run lead.
Does a 4-game set this weekend change anything, how you use a guy? I mean, it would only be an inning, and Johnson's probably going to throw a bullpen anyway.
It would only be an inning, but also you don't want that inning to be disastrous. You don't want him to go out there and throw 30 pitches, you know, on a cold night where he's had to wait now a while to even continue to get loose, and you already have a Jake McKenzie loose, throwing.
And getting outs quickly.
Yes, he is.
Here's Cantu. Cantu has walked a couple times, scored both times he walked, and had a single back in the 2nd. He's also done a nice job behind the plate. It's hard to believe he's a true freshman. Rips this to left field for a base hit. 18 hits for the Longhorns now.
You know, one person wants to make it 19.
The guy who hasn't got a hit yet?
The man about to step in the box, Zane Gerwitz. You know the teammates know it, that he's the only one.
Oh, you think they do?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
I would figure when you have 18 hits, you don't remember where they all went.
Who's got what?
Bases loaded, nobody out. Gerwitz saw some pretty nasty sliders his last time up.
Might be thinking something else right here. 2-0. Don't have a knock. Might as well make it a big one.
He's got the power. I'm not sure if tonight he does. But he's also shown some opposite field power in the fall.
Look at that pop. He's showing a good eye right now. It'd be very easy to have swung at these pitches without a hit, up 8 runs.
He can still get an RBI, though, with one more ball, so you gotta be thinking about that. Ball 4, and that is the 11th run of the game for Texas. RBI for Zane Gerwitz. Well, that'll bring up Ben Johnson. Let's take a look at the 7th inning and right back up the middle, but this is where it really changed. 2 would have come in.
2 would have been in. You see Markham, the center fielder, takes his eye off it. The ball takes a funny hop, but once it gets by him. So Ben Johnson put the afterburners on. Not needing to slide, but goes in head first.
You got to slide on it inside the park, don't you? Even if you don't have to.
Maybe not head first. Not a fan of that.
Turney trying to find the strike zone here. Johnson with 3 hits.
478 on the season.
Drops that in for a strike.
Said it before, lefties like this right up Ben Johnson's alley. He likes to hit off these guys. Cutter gets in on it.
Good pitch.
Very good pitch. Fooled Ben Johnson. Late on it. Tried to get around on it. Just cut him up.
At the back door. 2-2. Mentioned earlier how the Texas Tuesday games, because of the rise of programs like UTSA, you don't have the padding stats anymore. Now you're in that inning where you're just looking at pad stats. Ben not able to do that as he strikes out.
Goes down on the breaking ball.
So one out. Bring up Collin Shaw. Shaw's had a good day. He's got three hits. Chance for him to face another lefty. Texas with four runs in the seventh, four here in the eighth. After what Greg mentioned earlier was a very tight game heading into the seventh.
It also goes to show you, like on weekend games, Coach Marks would say that they pitched pretty much everyone that they had. So these games like this, and when it gets to a point where after Savage came in this game, that it was pretty much, you know, throw someone out there and hope you can get out of innings because your pitching is depleted. And that's what's happened tonight. To the Roadrunners, just not as deep as they would like to be.
Jason Marshall's done a good job in his third season there. You can tell just from talking to Augie, you can get a pretty good feel. He said, no, I said, they're well coached. This is a good baseball
team. Well, it was fun talking to him. Very animated, very likes his team, understands his team.
And you would think his message to his team after tonight is this was a 3-2 game late against the sixth team in the country.
Yes. We're playing well. We get a hit here. If they still catch that ball, it's still just a three-run game.
Right. Upstairs and another walk will bring home a run. The 12th run of the game for Texas, and they lead by 10.
And these are also good at bats. By Gerwitz, by Shaw right there. You're up as many as you are now, 10 runs. And you're still taking your walks. You're still seeing the ball. You're not trying to overdo anything and get more base hits.
Well, you were wrong, Zeke. They do have one more pitcher.
Oh, yeah.
We're going to find out who it is whenever we get back. Back here in the bottom of the eighth inning, bases loaded, one out. New pitcher, the eighth pitcher for the Roadrunners, and it's going to be Andrew Shoecraft, a sophomore from Pearland, Texas. One of three guys from Pearland High School on this team. I'm sure he knows Blake Goins very well, the sophomore right-hander for Texas, but
possibly Travis Duke.
Probably Travis Duke,
area.
Right. Andrew going to come in here and get some experience and face C.J. Hinojosa with the bases loaded here. Roadrunners trailing by 10.
.88. That's a good pop on that fastball. Not easy to sit down there for now going on close to 4 hours to come in and be able to pop a fastball like that and get loose.
How hard was that for you to get loose in cold weather situations if you are sitting there for 3 or 4 hours?
A while. Because you haven't. You don't expect to. When you get down there and try to get, can't rush it, especially in cold weather, because you could injure yourself. It'll take a good 5 or 10 minutes longer.
left side. This is going to be a no play for the shortstop, Straub, and CJ will definitely take that hit. After hitting the ball hard at Rice and not having much to show for it, he's had a couple that
this inning.
He'll definitely take this inning, exactly, including a double his last at bat. Couldn't have been thrown down the right field line any better.
Eleventh hitter of the inning for Texas right here. Yeah, it's one of those nights right now. I mean, the good pitches, that was a good pitch, and just bad location. It was hit right in the hole at short. Not much you can do with it if you're UTSA.
Well, in Texas, maybe getting a little karma, they hit, as I mentioned, some hard balls. And the way baseball works, Rice hit some balls that just trickled through. I think Augie said he counted they had, what, three or four that actually got through.
Little ground balls.
On ground balls, right. So a lot of that you can give credit to Rice, but that's just the way baseball works. Tonight, it's been a little opposite. Texas has seen those breaks come. Been impressed with Borman behind the plate. You can see why the scouts like him.
Well, he threw out Collin Shaw on a ball that was down low in the zone, and he got rid of that ball very quickly and on the money at second base.
Foul ball. Two balls, two strikes, one out. Just misses. Swing and a miss, and Brooks Marlowe goes down. Well, the UTSA pitchers have thrown a lot of pitches tonight. 187 pitches from the Roadrunners. Now, you would throw that in a game.
That's a Brooke Kieschnick game, right?
Right, it is. That's Kieschnick against Oklahoma State and Omaha.
Well, the two outs this inning, nine hitters have reached base. The two outs have both been strikeouts. Go figure.
Yeah, right. Here's Barrera, who just got into one.
Could you imagine?
His last time up, yes, I could with his pop. Hit a three-run shot. That was earlier this inning. Texas with a sixth spot in this inning. Three of those coming from number one. That took me back to the old days here at the dish when you could actually have a no-doubter.
Right.
Speaking of Kieschnick.
The no-doubter went 6 feet over the fence.
Oh, yeah. I mean, it was no doubter that.
I thought it was going over the bullpen wall. I mean, all the way out of the park. He hit it good. When he took off the bat, you knew it was out of the park.
Charles Johnson hit a shot here in 92 off of Doug Pettit for Miami Hurricanes that I still think is rolling near I-35.
Hit that 18-wheeler up there?
Man. But that was when it took off, it looked like it was going to go, and it did go. You've seen a little bit of a difference, and this is a ball right back up the middle. Tommy Nicholson throwing a lot of class, going to hold Collin Shaw. No reason to send him around. Trace is probably thinking, that would have been my fifth ribby this inning. But instead, he'll get another one. I believe he has six for the night now.
Five hits, six RBIs. Had your stat night for Longhorn hitters tonight.
Did.
Man, they're having a night.
All nine Texas players have scored a run tonight. Whoa. Texas not going anywhere.
Nah.
Well, obviously, Shaw's not going to try and advance after he could have scored on that base hit. But when you've got a scoreboard that looks like that and you're in the bottom of the eighth, no reason to pour it on.
20 hits. I'd like to know the last time there were 20 hits in a game.
I mean, maybe the 2010 team, that would be the soonest, but I mean.
What about that one game when they went to Missouri and they had like a 15-run lead and got beat? I think there were a lot of hits in that game.
You got beat like 32 to 12
or
something. Yeah, that one may qualify. For combined hits, at least. Boswell underneath this one. Kind of in that no man's land, and
it rains, it pours.
Yeah. Well,
it could have been worse if it was fair.
Fair, right.
That ball just. Everyone looking at each other.
You get the sense that they're obviously deflated. They do not have the same swag that they had early on in this game.
Looks like right there at the end that Skyler might have called him off. Deontay Jackson at first base. But
Boy, did you see the picture of Borman behind there? I mean, like you said, when it rains, it pours, and Texas has done a good job of putting the foot on the gas.
And also laying off.
And then
they could have scored a few extra runs.
Right. Once you lay it on and get to 13, you can lay it off. Swing and a miss gets Boswell to chase the off-speed pitch, and Texas is done here in the eighth. No doubt the damage is done, too. Tres Barrera, a no-doubter. In an era where there are no doubters, Texas trying to finish it off here in Austin. What an inning for Texas as they put up a 7th spot in the bottom of the 8th. They lead UTSA 14-2. Tres Barrera with a 3-run shot in that inning. 5 hits, 6 RBI, most hits in a game since March 20th, 2008. I was wrong on my guess. Michael Torres, transfer from USC.
Pretty good little player.
He was, and he got a lot better here, too.
Yeah, he did. You see that right there? Tres Barrera telling Andy McGuire, finish strong, finish strong.
Well, Andy McGuire is a very highly touted infielder from Oakton, Virginia, James Madison High School. Came here as a third baseman and now has transitioned into being a pitcher.
And has done a very good job.
What do you like about
it? Of transitioning, even though this will be his first actual appearance. Each time he throws a bullpen, each time he throws an inner squad, it gets better. His mechanics are good. He's got a good fastball. He can get it up to 91 miles an hour. Got a slider and a changeup to go with it. So obviously he's still developing as a pitcher.
What is Skip working on? Is it the mechanics?
Mechanics, yeah. I mean, with a new guy who hasn't pitched too much. He pitched growing up, you know, as a kid. But his mechanics have gotten better. And it's just a work in progress. And Skip believes in him because he does have a real good arm.
Misses with the fastball. This is up in
there
the air.
There we go.
And this is going to have to be caught by Tres. Nathan, he makes the play. One out.
Good job by Andy McGuire. Throwing some close pitches in there, not getting the call. Didn't let up. Bumped in the fastball and got the out. Still got a smile on Tres Barrera's face.
You get 5 hits and 6 ribbies. You're just coming off an inning where.
Well, you know someone's going to go
4 knockouts.
5 for 6? What happened to the one the other way?
Right.
He didn't swing at the first pitch. That was in there.
Yeah. Fastball's in there for a strike. We do have a pinch hitter here. It's JT Gilmore from Killeen, Texas. Went to Harker Heights. JT is a sophomore.
You see a breaking ball by Andy McGuire.
Where's his breaking ball compared to his other pitches right now?
I think it's he right there. I mean, he has better command of it. He's got good snap on it. I mean, for a guy that hasn't pitched too much as far as game-type competition.
Snap that one, huh?
He's really looking good.
Outside. Well, this was a very competitive game for about 6.5 innings. Texas led 3-2 heading into the bottom of the seventh. We're able to get four runs and then just really blow it open as strike three is called. And UTSA is down to their final out.
See Michael Cantu set up outside, but sometimes you don't hit your target over the inside part of the plate. Andy McGuire gets his first collegiate strikeout.
Last chance is Kevin Markham. Markham had a huge error in center field. And the Ben Johnson single allowed all four to come home. Markham, though, he is going to be a huge part of this team. He and John Borman can provide some power, and Markham can really go get it in center field. Like you said, I think you're exactly right. I think because he's so fast and athletic, he thought he had a shot at home, and he just was over-aggressive.
Looked up, peeked up a little bit. Ball gets through his legs.
Got a little payback. The base hit to right field. Keeping UTSA alive. A little bit jawing back and forth in this game. And you saw that right there. There's just the eyes from the Texas bench to Markham.
A little deer back there.
Well, if you've been paying attention, I know you have. There's been some lip back and forth for a Tuesday game. Ben Brookover is going to be the pinch hitter, the freshman from San Antonio. This is another one of those freshmen we talked about. Ben's expected to be in the lineup a lot. And he's one of those guys that Coach Marshall thinks can really drive the baseball and is only going to get better. Second. Marlowe's going to take his time, and this one is done. Nice job by Andy McGuire to come on and finish it off. Tres Barrera said, close it out strong, and number five did. A strong offensive effort for Texas.
Going very strong. Everybody contributed. A lot of hits, walks, aggressive on the bases when they needed to be. And I tip my hat to Jake McKenzie coming in there in the seventh inning with two outs, getting out of a jam, kept it at a one-run game, and after that, Texas put on an 11th spot on them in two innings.
You started this telecast off by talking about Texas offense, and what you saw from the four-game set at Rice was this is a gritty team and mentally tough team, especially at the plate. 17 strikeouts on that Sunday. They come back and win after being down. Tonight, 1-for-12 with runners in scoring position. And they put up a 4 spot and a 7 spot to finish it off. Kind of gets back to what you're talking about, not letting previous failures determine the next couple innings.
They're living the moment, believing in themselves in that situation, and taking, it's very cliche-ish, but taking a bat by a bat, pitch by pitch. That's what this team did. They stayed in the game for 7 innings and then put up 11 spot and really just blew it away after that.
Gerwitz getting some love from Coach Augie Garrido. You can even see it. Look at him. He likes this baseball team. He likes the makeup. And I think he's going to like what happens this year. 1,400th win at the dish for Texas.
Well, once again, our final score, Texas 14 and UTSA 2. The Longhorns with 11 runs in their final two innings to really break this thing wide open. Texas finishes with 14 runs, 20 hits, one error. Roadrunners, two runs, eight hits. Also committed an error. Tres Barrera probably got to be your player of the game. Five hits and six runs knocked in for the sophomore. Well, be sure to tune in to LHN Wednesday for hoops as the Texas women take on Kansas State. That'll be at 7 p.m. Central. I believe we're going to see if we can't get Tres Barrera set up here. The hero of this game. Greg, anything else defensively or pitching-wise that stood out to you in this one?
I'd just like to see the guys that got in there. I like the Connor Mays threw a solid three innings. I like Jake McKenzie coming in and showing some savvy and getting out of that inning. Just the guys, Andy McGuire getting his first inning in. Tyler Shimp maybe learning a lesson tonight. But the pitching did well. The defense played good. The missed pop fly over here by Can too. I mean, just didn't hurt anyone. But the all in all was a real good game and a close game until the seventh inning. And then it was
Tres Barrera.
It was a little bit of Tres Barrera, yes.
Let's go ahead and get down to the field then, Mr. Tres Barrera. Five hits, six runs knocked in. I want to get to the three-run homer. You know, in this park, especially at this time of the year, nothing goes out. Did you know it was gone?
No, I didn't. I mean, earlier during BP, the wind was blowing straight in, and it kind of sucked hitting BP earlier. But, I just put a good swing on the ball, saw the ball well, and it went out.
So, man, you're 5 for 6. You know what I'm going to ask? What happened on the other time you didn't get a hit, man?
Oh, man, I just got jammed inside. I got down in the count. When you get down in the count, that's what happened.
Well, Trace, you mentioned being down in the count. I know at least on four of your hits, they were first pitches. Is that something that you're going up there really looking for a certain first pitch and go after it?
I mean, yeah, that's one of our models early this year, to be aggressive and be ready to hit every pitch. And the pitch is there, take a hack at it. And that's what I did today, and put good swings on the ball.
All right, for all the Texas fans that are tuning in for the first Longhorn Network broadcast this year, what can they expect from this team?
Fighters, man. That's what we have. That's the type of guys we have on this team. We worked hard in the offseason. We came together, and no matter what the score is, no matter what we're going through, we're going to keep fighting to the very end, and that's the type of team we're going to be.
All right, Trace, next time Greg asks you when you went 5 for 6, what happened on the other one, tell him just don't worry about it. All right?
Thanks,
Trace. Appreciate
respect,
it.
Respect, man. Respect.
Thank you.
Well, that's going to do it for us. Once again, Texas 14, UTSA 2. The Texas Bats certainly got hot. Be sure to tune in to LHN Wednesday for hoops as the Texas women will take on Kansas State. That is at 7 Central. Coming up next, Longhorn Extra. They're going to have you covered with everything. For Brad Sheldon, our director, Drew Irvine, our producer, and Greg Swindell, I'm Kevin Dunn. So long from the dish.